Blog Talk Radio.
You're listening to the Totally Driven Entertainment Radio Network.
In the future, none of you are heroes.
You're legends.
Get driven. Stay driven.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and thank you for tuning in to our Thursday night programming of Totally Driven Radio. But why wouldn't you tune into the greatest show heard all around the world?
Here we are, everybody. It's Thursday night. Time to get driven. That's right. Totally Driven Radio. We are live on the air, and we are not only are we nationwide, but we are freaking worldwide, all around the globe. And you never know. You could be one of the areas they're getting a bomb dropped on you as well. So, no laugh from my co-host. I was waiting for a laugh. But anyway, my name is Bay Ragni, and we got a special show for you tonight. We have we're doing one of our Knievel specials. Usually we do, you know, the man himself, Mr. Evel Knievel. We do some specials dedicated to a certain special jump in the past. Like we've done the Snake River Canyon, we've done Wembley Stadium, and we've had a bunch of the Knievel crew, the guys that used to run around and help Evel and you know, work on the bikes, the ramps, and drive his limo or get him out of jail or whatever may have you. We've had them all call in, tell amazing stories. Well, tonight we're going to take it a step further due to the idea of my co-host. And I thought it was a fabulous idea as soon as he brought it to me. So let's introduce my co-host, because he's the one who has really put all these Knievel specials together. The one and the only, the Pitbull, the ATV Daredevil himself, Mr. Henry Rife. What's going on there, buddy?
How you doing, Bay? Yeah, that's quite the introduction, so I hope I live up to it.
Come on. You always live up to the introduction.
I certainly hope so. Yeah, these Knievel podcasts are pretty awesome, and I hope all your listeners are really digging these specials we do, because I sure had a lot of fun doing it and learn all kinds of shit I never knew before about the Knievel family.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because, I mean, before we started doing all these specials, like I was like the fan growing up as the little kid in the 70s. And then, you know, you had that big gap of time that just went by that, I mean, for a person like me, I really didn't know what was going on. And then I would see the occasional, like when Robbie would come to the area, do some jumps and all. And then when he started doing TV appearances, I was like, okay, cool. But until the internet really came to fruition, you kind of lost contact with that whole Knievel thing.
Yeah, I agree. We're a generation, the Generation Xers went out there as a little kid and watched a guy in red, white, and blue fly through the air. And then when he retired for what, 12, 14 years, and then all of a sudden the red, white, and blue started flying through the air again. And it was the son of Evel, Robbie, and wow, he did it. You know, there's a lot of purists out there that think Knievel is the end-all, be-all, and I'm certainly right up there. But to not give Robbie credit for doing it bigger and better would definitely be a shame. And, you know, he deserves his own special, so I'm glad you were into it.
Yeah, I mean, and I think you really, like, the title of the movie, I mean, really just sums up the whole thing with Robbie and, you know, chasing evil, where here is a guy who his father, he created the sport of motorcycle daredevil. He became that, like you said, that superhero to us kids of the 70s. He became that real life gladiator. And, you know, to be the son to have to live in those footsteps, it is a tough job in itself. But then when you go on and you actually, you're beating your father's records, but you still don't get the respect. It's like you're always chasing that shadow. And that's why I just love the title they came up with Chasing Evil for the documentary.
Yeah, one of the guests we have on tonight is Mr. Lathan McKay. He's a dear friend of mine. And he has single-handedly really brought about the resurgence of the old school daredevils. I kind of pride myself as being like a bridge between the two. I mean, I wear an Evel Knievel outfit and I jump with an ATV. So it's some of the old, some of the new. And Lathan has come along in a very short period and done more than anybody else that wasn't a performer, and he's right up there with most of the performers. I mean, he's restored Evel Semi, Big Red. He's acquired most of his leathers, most of his canes and jewelry and trinkets and, the motorcycles. Yeah, he's got, I think, all of the motorcycles. So he has a collection that spans millions. And this is really a labor of love for him, and his passion is very contagious. And I've spent some time with him, and he's a great guy. And we'll hear a little bit more about what he's doing with the museum and these movies he's made. Anybody that hasn't watched the first documentary, Being Evel, is really missing out. They need to watch that. That is the best Evel Knievel documentary I ever seen. And everything I hear about Chase Evel is it's better than that. So I'm excited to see it.
I am too. I can't wait. You know, and I mean, Lathan has become, he's become like a hero to myself. I know that for sure, because I mean, he's really, like you said, he's continued waving that red, white, and blue flag for Evel, for Robbie, for the whole Knievel family, and really bringing into the new millennium, they're giving that teaching kids of today what they missed out on that we got to enjoy in the 70s. And the scary part is with Lathan, though, like, he's like, I think 10 to 15 years, yeah, younger than me and you.
Yep.
Which is scary.
You know, go ahead, buddy.
No, I was gonna say, it's just scary that, you know, here's somebody who's 10 to 15 years younger than us, and it wasn't even really alive during those years of Evel, and he's become such a huge fan and supporter.
Well, he's definitely kindred spirit. He was a pro skateboarder, and so, you know, he knows about taking hard licks in life and being a T-type personality. And I don't know. Really not sure how the Knievel bug bit him, but when it bit him pretty hard, because, wow, he's made a whole industry out of this. And I don't know about you, but it's amazing to me that one guy could manage to put all this together. You know, you have the fantasies that, you know, one day I'll win the lottery and I would buy this and I'd restore that and I would do this, but he's actually done it. And when they unveiled Big Red, I cried. And, you know, for years I was harping on the internet. I'm big on all the Knievel, you know, blogs. And that's where I met Mike Draper. I just pissed and moaned that the truck was just deteriorating. And he come along and restored it. And, man, the thing looks like brand new. And he's doing the same with the bikes and, you know, his displays he has. And, wow, I think of, you know, almost 7 billion people on the planet. He's the only one that can manage to put this together. So I love the guy for it.
Yeah, like he's gone and done, like, what probably me and you would love to do, but we just don't have the money to do it. and probably, like, if we did have the money and we started spending the money like that, our wives might kick our asses.
Oh, well, you know, my wife she's a peach. Stacy is, she's the best thing, one of the best things that ever happened to me for sure. And she wouldn't give me any hell over it as long as we had some money to live. She would be backing me 100%. But I don't possess the brains, the wherewithal, or most importantly, the money to go about doing this. And you know, I've spoken with Lathan, and he's told me, you know, there's been times where he wanted to give up, and he thought, you know, going through all this was going to kill him, all the stress. And so, you know, it's easy to, I said one time, man, you're doing this exactly how I would have done it. And he got mad at me. And I think he thought I was cheapening what he's done. And I had to explain to him that, you know, he shares the same love that I have for not only the Knievels, but, you know, Daredevils and certainly my past. You know, I'm sure you can identify. We live in our childhood every time we see this stuff.
And, oh, absolutely.
Yeah, it's a time machine. And, you know, how often do you get the chance to do that? You know, I mean, he's doing something. He's pulling heartstrings with people that most people would never be able to do. And I think it's pretty awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I can't thank him enough. I really can't. Because it does, it truly does make us feel young again. By him keeping the whole Knievel spirit alive. And that goes to Robbie, too. You know, because Robbie, you know, every time you see those leathers fly through the air, you get that feeling. You get that, you know, and even you, Henry, when I see you fly through the air wearing those leathers, you know, you get that flashback to being that kid again. So for that, you know, 7-8 seconds, you're airborne, you know, you get that feeling.
I've certainly had some of the feelings of smashing into the pavement too. So, take my word for it. Don't do it. Just watch the successful jumps and cheer us on. And those crashes, those are mulligans.
Now, I got to meet Robbie one time back in, like, I think it was around 87 or 88 at a World of Wheels car show here in Philadelphia. And that was like the touring car show. You go all around the country. And he was there, and I went over to him and got the chance to meet him. And I asked him, I said, I'm like, dude, like, when you crash, like, how do you get back up on that bike to go do it again? I'm like, don't you just, like, be like, that's it, I'm done, that's enough. And he's like, you know what? He goes, every time I crash, I think that and I feel that way, and I say I'm done, no more. And then I go onto the construction site and I say, I'm done, no more. And I go back on the motorcycle.
Well, I can tell you, the worst crash I ever had was in 1995. I jumped a 70-foot-long mobile home with about a 40-foot gap in front of it. It was, overall, it was about a 140-foot jump. And I didn't do it right. I took too small of a ramp. I had to go way faster than I should have. and it actually bucked me off the quad, so I did a Superman over the whole thing. And I had a very serious illness, and I had about a foot of my intestines taken out about a month and a half before that. And I shouldn't have done it, but I did. And when I crashed, I had to let go of the quad because I was afraid of internal bleeding from that operation. So I let the quad go. I hit the ground, broke both my legs, broke an arm, broke a collarbone, and broke a wrist. And then it knocked me out for 45 minutes. And let me tell you something. I felt like I've been pounded by a sledgehammer all over my body. I've never felt pain like that ever. And that's the only time I ever hollered that I didn't want to jump anymore. And it lasted about 48 hours, and then I was ready to heal up and get back on it. So I just think it's who we are, what we do. That's certainly what I was made to do, and I know Robbie. And he is probably, in my, you know, you have these guys out here that jump off of these mega ramps, you know, and I have a friend, his name's Jason Bird. He's a jumper, and he's jumping 500 feet on dirt bikes.
That's insane.
Super. Oh, that's crazy. But it's all crazy. But Robbie has probably been the most innovative, certainly one of the most talented. And, you know, not only has he followed in his father's footsteps, he's you know, money-wise, he probably hasn't outdone him, but talent-wise, it's not even close. And, you know, he certainly, there's been a lot of friction with Evel and Robbie all through Robbie's life, and I just think it's because they're exactly alike, don't you?
Oh, yeah. Like father, like son.
Well, I agree. I know Robbie. We're friends, and, you know, we're not super close, but we do enjoy each other's company, and, you know, I've met him five times now. I've been around him five times, and every time I'm around him, the guy could not be any nicer. And you know, we have you know, so far into the Knievel stuff, you know, that I wear the outfits and everything. We've talked about it, and you know, it's a homage. You know, it's certainly not trying to take anything away from the name or any of that. It's meant as a bit of appreciation, and guys have done.
Sure.
So,
now,
you know, go ahead.
How many times have you seen Robbie jump?
Let's see. Well, I got a good story for you. If you got a little bit of time, and
we got some time. We got Lathan will be calling in. The infamous Lathan McKay will be calling in about 8:30.
Okay, so this will just take a couple minutes, but it is a very sweet story. I had a when I was 20, so this would put it back in right around 1989. A beautiful girl, you know, she was couple years younger than me, and we dated, and the summer we dated, I kept hearing Robbie Knievel was going to jump the fountain of Caesar's Palace, and this went on, you know, you hear the occasional couple second news drop in the news, you know, they drop his name, and, you know, hyping the show and all this, and all through that summer, I suppose it was the summer of 88, leading up to 89. And this girl I dated, she, in November, she got sick. And we found out she had leukemia. And she spent several months in the hospital. And we went through all that, and it became apparent that she wasn't going to pull through it. I got a phone call to go see her. And it happened to be on the very night Robbie Knievel was jumping the fountains at Caesar's Palace. She suffered through all this, and I sit there and was holding her hand, and we heard on the radio that Robbie just successfully jumped the fountains, and I listened to that, and she looked at me, and she couldn't really even talk. She just whispered, "So he made it, huh?" And I said, "Yeah." And it wasn't, well, I don't know, it was less than 2 hours later, she was gone.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah. So that jump has a lot of meaning every time I see it. But the other part about it, a few years ago, I did a jump in Pennsylvania and signing autographs and taking pictures was Robbie Knievel. He was there. And he seen me come out of the tent all dressed up like him and his dad. And, yeah, he really wasn't into, I don't think he was into watching the ATV jump until he saw me dressed up, you know, the care I went in. I mean, my leathers are exact. You can,
right.
You've seen me.
Mm-hmm.
So, flying over, and we started talking, and I told him that story. And you could just see the, you know, that touched him. And yeah, I thought that was extremely sweet and caring of him. He stood there and listened to that. And he asked all kinds of questions about her. And that was one of my great Robbie moments. He, you know, and then he walked up the stage and he wasn't supposed to do it, and he introduced me. And his daughter sung the national anthem, and that was, I have it on video, but I haven't shared that with anybody yet, but that was pretty awesome.
Wow.
So that's my Caesar's Robbie story. I've met him, let's see, the first time I met him was in Las Vegas. He was jumping for Fox TV. He did the 30 limo jump, and
oh.
I went and saw that, and I was a guest of Evel Knievel. He sent me a plane ticket, and so I had Evel Knievel call me up on the phone and ask me if I want to come to Vegas. Really? You got to ask me twice? No way.
Yeah, right.
I was there. Yeah, that was pretty awesome. So I got to meet Evel, and along with that, I got to hang out with Robbie for a little bit, and Dan Haggerty tried to fight me. Yeah, so that was an interesting night. Matthew McConaughey was there, and Michael Jackson's dad was there. Who else? What's that?
I said, which person doesn't belong?
There was a couple, and then it was like a summit meeting for Daredevil. Bubba Blackwell was there, Lewis Ree. I don't know if Doug Danger was there or not, but I think he was. You know, there was you know, these Daredevils are pretty tight crowd, and you go to a Robbie jump, you see all the old 70s Daredevils, and you know, it's great to see them guys. I tend to not do that. Not that there's anything wrong with it, you know. I don't want to be a hanger on. I'm a fan and I'm a friend, but I you know, I'm not the type to ride on people's coattails. So and I'm not saying anybody's doing that. I just never wanted the, you know, people to think that. But then I seen him at Kings Island here in Ohio, and that was that was an awesome jump. He made it by like a foot.
Wow.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. And let's see, just a couple months ago, he was back here in Ohio in Dayton, and I had to hop in the old Cherokee and still paying a visit, and as I was walking down the hill, he signed an autograph, and he looked up and seen me, and had a big old smile on his face, and You know, he looked pretty tired. He looked like he wasn't feeling very well. But he ran over and hugged me, and we talked a couple minutes, and then we got out of there. But I've got a nice friendship with him. He's a great guy.
Nice. That's awesome. Now, did you say you actually you jumped while he was there at one time?
Yeah, I did. In Pennsylvania, at the there's an event called the Cornfield 500. You guys need to look this up on the internet. They do it every year. That is a really cool deal they have. It's a race, but they have side acts and stuff. And Sabrina Miller and her husband Blank, they had us there, and they had Robbie there, and you know, they really didn't do exactly what I wanted. They basically give me an open area and no landing ramp. But Robbie was watching, so I hit that takeoff ramp with everything I had, and I was flatlanding it pretty much. And, man, that was knocking the shit out of me. But there's Robbie over on the sidelines. Yeah, yeah, that was pretty neat. So, and then he walked over and gave me a necklace. And, he's a great guy.
That's awesome. Now, did you feel like to put it this way, like, you're jumping in front of a Knievel, like, pressure? Any pressure at all?
Absolutely. I mean, I wish it, well, and you know, I always wanted to jump, in front of Evel. And I kind of got the chance to do that. I did David Letterman. When was that? 07, something like that. And they had a writer's strike, if you remember. So, like, 3 weeks later, they showed that again. They got put back on there. And he was not doing well health-wise. And I sent... I sent a message, and I believe Crystal got it, his wife, and I said something like, hey, this is going to be on, and he knows me, and if you have the opportunity, could you, get him to watch that? And I got a message that said he watched it and loved it. So I got that done. And then Robbie's standing there watching me jump in Pennsylvania. And, yeah, man, you're not going to half-ass it when one of your heroes is there. Would you not swing for the fences if Babe Ruth was watching?
Oh, right. Well, the way I was going to spin this whole question was, imagine how he must have felt performing in front of his father all those years, especially as a child.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I agree. I mean, and I've always heard, I don't know this for a fact, because I have to say, both Robbie and Evel, in my presence, people warned me not to go. They said, these guys are, they're this way or that way. And, they said I was, several people said I was going to be disappointed. And I went and hung out with Evel, and he couldn't have been any nicer. And I was touched. Again, this was in 98, and a week before that, my sister passed, and he heard about that. And he spent a couple minutes and talking to me about that. And, they didn't have to do that. And it that meant a lot to me, that all these people are pestering them for autographs and stuff, and they took a few minutes to talk to us. So they couldn't have been any nicer around me. But I've always heard that, these guys are kind of grumpy, and they're kind of this and they're kind of that. I've never seen that. But growing up, some people can evil. The guy's name is Evel. That should be an indication that he don't take no shit.
Right.
And, He nicknamed his son Kaptain, as in comic book character, I don't know who's the superhero, Captain Marvel, whatever. Well, I mean,
America. You
got a family like that. You got dynamite waiting to happen, I'm sure.
Now, I was wondering how he got the nickname Captain. So it was his dad that did it?
Yeah, that's my understanding. When he jumped and cleared the fountain, that was his Caesar's Palace. Evel did it in 67, and then Gary Wells tried it in 1980, I think. And, wow, if you guys haven't ever seen that crash, you need to look that up on YouTube. That's pretty gnarly.
Yeah.
But,
Gary.
89 rolls around, and Robbie does it. And, people are making a big deal. If you watch the show, I have it on tape. People make the big deal because Gary Wells rode past these ramps or something. And supposedly, when Gary crashed, he blamed it on Evel Knievel or Robbie Knievel and their minions moving the ramp at night, which is complete bullshit. Did you know that?
That he blamed? I didn't know he blamed them. I know
he said that one of the Knievels had people move his ramps in the middle of the night, which is really, I mean, come on. You just didn't hit the ramp straight. We all do it. I've done it. Nobody's going to try and get you hurt. I mean, that's just ridiculous to say something like that. And I, knowing Robbie, there's no way.
Yeah.
But, he comes along and he pulls it off, and he made it look easy. Most of these jumps, I've had people tell me over the years, he made that look too easy. Well, there's a four-wheeler. You can swing a leg over it, and you can give it a shot, and we'll see how easy it is. Same thing with him, man. He went out there, and he just did it absolutely perfect. And his dad made the comment, so I've heard, so is the folklore, that only a superhuman could have done that, a superhero. He must be Captain Robbie Knievel. Now, he also made the comment that, as Robbie was growing older, that he was also the captain of his own ship. So that might be a little bit into that too, but that's the story I was always told.
All right, well, let's welcome to the show. I know this is definitely one person, so let's get him on the line. Let's welcome to the show the man we've been talking about for the last half hour, and it's not the captain yet. It's the one and the only Mr. Lathan McKay. What's going on there, buddy?
Testing 128980.
Yes.
How's it going?
You passed your test.
What's up, Henry? What's up, Henry?
How you doing, buddy?
Bay, how you doing? You guys find did you find Jesse James Miller yet?
Well, let's see if this is him on the line. Because there's been other people been calling it throughout the show.
Better be, or it's not Don Rickles.
I sure hope I am.
Definitely not.
There he is. It's not Don Rickles. Although that would have been pretty impressive.
I would have been dead.
Well, that would have been not too good. But anyway, let's welcome to the show the producer, writer, and director of Chasing Evel, Mr. Jesse James Miller. How you doing there, buddy?
Good. I'm good, man. How are you? What's going on?
Good. Good.
He's Canadian. He's great.
Honored to be with Lathan again.
We go
way back.
Hell.
We've been through hell.
So I guess you and Lathan have been friends before this whole Knievel extravaganza started, or?
Actually, I met him throughout the process. I think I met him on our
Evel Days in Evel's truck. Actually.
I was kind of waiting to find a sane person in the process of making this film, and I kind of looked over and I thought, he doesn't look sane, but maybe he is. And once he started talking, I thought, oh, God, at least somebody human. So that's how I met Lathan. No, he was great right away, and I think because he'd been through a couple other Evel films, he knew what I was dealing with and helped out from that minute forward.
Now, were you a fan of the whole Knievel family going into this, or did you become a fan?
I mean, I'm a filmmaker, so I'm not a fan per se. I had done big bio docs before, one on Boom Boom Mancini, Life Story of Him. So
love that.
No, thank you. Yeah, honestly, when I always knew about Robbie, I always knew about Ray, but I didn't spend a lot of time as a Knievel fan, no, but I became one throughout the making of it for sure.
Now, how about like when you're going through this and making this, when you're finding out this stuff, especially with Robbie's life and things he's gone through and, you know, battles he's had and the whole, again, I keep saying it, the title of the movie, Chasing Evel, I think it just sums it up. Did it kind of blow you away at times?
Yeah, I mean, I can't lie. Every time you get involved in one of these things, it's life threatening. I think that, yeah, that's the whole process of making a film about somebody's life. There's a lot of twists and turns. Robbie's was especially difficult just in terms of the scope and the scale of. It's always difficult dealing with somebody who's alive. With Ray, he was in the entertainment industry. He knew about it. With Robbie, you know, you're telling somebody's story while they're alive, and there's a lot of twists and turns with doing a film like that. So, Robbie is, you know, I love Robbie. He's a very sophisticated guy. He's very layered and complex, and there's a reason for that. That's what you'll see in the film itself. That's the title. So, you know, I think he's really misunderstood. That's a big thing that I misunderstood him, I think, when I first did my reading. But I was intrigued by him right away, and I flew down to Vegas and met with him. And he was in rough shape at the time, and he sobered up, and we started filming, you know, and the rest is history.
Now, was that like one of the things that you guys, like, did you say to him, like, you guys want him to...
I think he sort of said it to me. I think I said to him, this isn't going to work. You know, there's too much risk here. His story is a fantastic historical story. But then when he phoned me and said, hey, let's do this. And we started. So it was both of our impetuses. And my partner, Ken Johns, who shot it as well. We were kind of a trio at the time.
Wow.
Polyamorous.
Now, when you get that green light, like, all right, this is a go. Like, for you, what do you have to do now? Like,
there's a lot of complexities to that because there's financiers involved, there's broadcasters involved. So a lot of that behind the scenes work had to happen before we started shooting. Well, before, so that's another story. But I honestly. Robbie's story, if you look on Wikipedia, how many pages for Evel? 56 or something?
Right.
Robbie has like one or two. That's what was the intriguing part about the story and doing the doc is because there's so much about his life that is, I would say, like the caller before, I didn't catch your name. Sorry about that. I just didn't hear enough. But, you know, there's a lot of stories about Robbie, but I don't know. There's a lot of lore, you know,
yeah. But
there's not a lot of truth to a lot of the things. So, you know, I did a lot of writing and we spend a lot of time in Butte, which is a character in the movie itself. you know, I mean, Butte's a special place, huh, Lathan? I mean, come on, you can't.
It's talk about complicated. It's one of the most historically complicated places in the United States for sure.
And I think that, you know, that became a character in the film as well, because I think Knievel's, you have to understand Butte, you know. There's a lot in that story. There's a lot of layers to Butte that make sense when you understand the city. Or I wouldn't even call it a city. What do you call it, a town?
It's an entity.
It's an entity. It's an amoeba. It's a living thing.
Wait, you're talking about the Berkeley Pit now.
Yeah. No duck will live on landing.
No.
So, you know, these things take time too, right? A lot of docs are, this is the fastest doc I've ever made, and it took 2 years. So, you know,
wow.
These take time. But with Robbie, it was really about the thread was a modern thread that hung all the historical times in his life. So it sort of intercuts between now and back then. And a lot of it had to do with his sobriety and him jumping in again, which he did successfully in the film.
Nice.
Yeah,
wow.
You're going to see the climactic sort of piece at the end of the film is shot fantastically. It's most beautiful, one of the most beautiful sequences of a jump I've seen.
Yeah, I mean, that thanks, Lathan. But it's basically an epic father-son story. So, I mean, you can fill in the blanks there. The end jump, yeah, you know.
Is there any, like, any tearful moments? Any tearful moments, and moments that could make a person cry?
Oh, God.
I mean, there's a lot
pretty,
of tears.
It's pretty emotional, yeah.
That's what I mean. That's what I'm expecting, like a very emotional.
Well, you gotta ask Jesse, talk about the first time Robbie saw the film. You know, I mean, it's difficult to grasp if you're not him, but it's just a powerful piece. And, you know, his initial viewing of the film had to shake him up a little bit, to say the least.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, the thing you have to remember is because these things take so much time and they go over a span of years. The same thing happened with Ray. I mean, when I first showed it to Ray, it was, you know, it was tough, man. I mean, he took it and we hugged after, and thank God I was there physically. With Robbie, it was, you know, him alone watching it, which I didn't want to happen. I wanted it to be in a theater and with people around him, but He, you know, you have to ask him. I think he's come full circle, which I know he has, after the viewing in Missoula with his family. His family loved it, so that. But it's a different take, man. It's not a highlight film,
right?
You know, it's not a highlight film. So, I mean, there's highlights in it. You know, the Caesars jump is fully in it, and his Fox days are in it. But this is the intricate story between a father and a son at a high level.
Yeah.
Very high level.
Now like you were saying how it took like over 2 years to do, and this is the quickest one. But how much, like, the scary part is how much footage did you have to go through?
Well,
you want to talk about? You want to talk? Yeah. No. Well, when I got back to the vault, we had this vault where we kept a lot of stuff. It's kind of a bunker underneath the ground here. Where we kept all the perishable, you know, like footage, all of Evel's footage included, but some of the stuff we saved from this guy we acquired, it actually was, I'd say, 300 or 400 pounds of every inch and shot of Robbie's career. So it was an arduous task, to say the least, but you go in, when I was talking to Jesse, the first thing I did was gather up out of 20,000 photographs was I cherry picked what I thought would contribute to the film. And I mailed that to Jesse. And then the next step was, I think it was three of those full camping trunks full of footage.
Four.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. It was five to 600 tapes in various mediums and formats, all the way from VHSC to, you know, so I shipped that to Jesse and he had an intern. You know, and part of that stuff wasn't the story, but they did get what they needed out of it. But the footage, which we've sent back to Kristen Knievel to save for her, you know, for Robbie's grandkid to have for the future, it was just enormous, and I think the kid would still be watching it to this day.
Well, you know, unfortunately, the kid didn't last long. So I ended up. Basically, what ended up happening is that you start to have to go through it yourself, and you can't actually physically capture all of it. So we did the best we could. I think a lot of it was falling apart, and because of the time period, because of the VHS dropouts and stuff like that, a lot of the stuff's dead. So we did the best we. There's a lot of stuff in that film that I don't think has ever been seen before.
No, especially the photographs. I sent you stuff that we'd been kind of holding on to. I think people are going to be excited to see, you know, like for instance, the picture of Robbie playing drums with his Kiss makeup on and things of that nature.
Yeah.
Classic.
There's Jesse did a great job too. He initially had this, you know, this background, this digitized background of, he was trying to capture the 70s aesthetic for to place the photos on. And when I first saw someone, I was like, oh dude, let's use the curtains from Evel's truck, which I don't know if everybody knows, that was the hardest thing to restore on Evel's rig were the curtains. Cause we had one sample and then I had to have it scanned and duplicated. And so I sent him the sample of that. And so the background you see in that portion of the film is the curtain pattern from Evel's semi. But there's a lot of authenticity in there.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time with in every decade, in the historical sections in every decade, there's a specialized background for everything. So Lathan's talking about the 70s portion. And so, you know, a lot of time was spent on trying to get as close to the authentic time as we could. You know, no one will ever know, but as filmmakers, we're at least trying to do that. Yeah.
So what is the plan now with the film? Like, I think you guys are doing like a tour, it looks like, film festival tour? Or?
Yeah. I mean, like every independent feature, we have a sales agent, distributor and a broadcaster and before it goes to air, which I think is in September, we get like a contracted film festival circuit time built into the contract. So we have until September. We've done a couple. We're doing Nashville coming up a couple weeks, Lathan.
Next Thursday and Friday.
Yeah, next Thursday, Friday. We go to Edmonton after that on May 12th, I think. And then there's a bunch more coming up in the summer. Based on how well that film does after the broadcast, then we might do a exclusive theatrical with Robbie, that's the intent. We would do six cities, with Robbie. But that's sort of out of our hands. It's up to the numbers and the agents and, you know, the business part. You know, we have that ready with Robbie. It's just if it can be set up. I think that, you know, this kind of stuff that we do, with your help, you know, getting it out there and getting people out to see it is really essential for the ground movement of any film. Although, you know, we do have a broadcaster, but it just helps to get the groundswell going. A lot of people don't remember Robbie or Evel. Some generations don't know, you know, which think about that. I mean, for us old codgers, it's like, well, you don't know Evel Knievel? No,
yeah.
I don't know Evel Knievel. It's like these 20-year-olds, right?
It's scary. Yeah. My own kids, if it wasn't for me, they would like look at me like, who, what did he do?
Yeah, I know. It's a weird thing, you know, and, like, I'd be hanging out in L.A. with Ray, and, you know, I'm with the lightweight champ of the world, Boom Boom, and nobody, you know, a lot of people, like, 30 and up, hey, Ray, how you doing? And then, but, you know, the 15-year-olds and the 20-year-olds, have no idea.
Everyone else is staring at their cell phone.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
They're playing Pokemon Go.
Playing Candy, Candy Crush or whatever the hell it is.
But I think, you know, in conclusion, you know, like, there's a lot of people need to know about Robbie because he's like the last of the Mohicans, you know? And I don't know if he'll ever jump again. We might have seen the last of that, maybe. He hurt himself pretty bad on our jump. Really bad. He had a couple back surgeries after. And so it's kind of like, you know, not many people get that opportunity to see old school jumper, you know. Right. I mean, he's not jumping 500 feet, but he's jumping. Those are thin fucking ramps. Oops. Those are thin ramps, man. I mean, I walk them, and I'm like, why, Robbie, why don't you make this wider? Can't, man. Can't. What do you mean you can't? You just make it wider. No, man, this is, my dad did this, you know.
You know,
not
that's
see
a
that anymore.
Question I always wondered myself. Like, those little, like, the little strips that they put together for, like, these runways, and it would always freak me out. Like, I'd be afraid just to fall off of the thing.
Well, you should be. You're human. These guys are human. Lathan knows a lot more about that, but I always questioned Robbie when we were at the jump, like, why don't you have a wider takeoff ramp? You know, but the old school guys didn't do it that way. So I don't know.
I don't know everything, but I just know that having a wider landing ramp is essential to, at least it's not the other way around.
Yeah. Right.
Well,
which,
you know,
be,
the crazy,
that would be the Polak Konolak joke, I think.
Well, the crazy part is like, you know, I don't want to give away our film, but there's an accident that happens, and we were like, he knew that that was going to happen, and he still jumped.
So he
I mean,
knew
what kind of person does that? Well, they just didn't have enough room in the area to land. So, I mean, it's not really – we don't go into the detail of that, but – these are the old school daredevils, man. They don't make them like that anymore.
As long as there's some hay bales around, it's a go.
Yeah, I know, but the hay bales are damn hard, man.
I know. I'm just saying.
Right?
That's the green light is the hay bales.
The hay bales is the green light, but they're like cement, and no kid in their right mind will do that now. But the Knievels, they just if they said they were going to do it, they did it. You know, like what kind of people are they? Right.
The hay bales are essential. Like if you look in all the like all the Robbie clips that you can find, like on YouTube, there is hay bales at the ending of every ramp that he goes into.
Well, the thing about Robbie, and I think really people have to understand, is that he was so poetically amazing in the air. Like he was so good at what he did. He was far better than his dad, and his dad even said that, and Kenny Brown says that in the film, and he made things look really easy, and I think that might have taken away from his brilliance, you know, because he was brilliant. He really was. He was a virtuoso kind of bike rider that he spent more time on his bike than his dad. You know, yes, he had a different bike and lighter suspension and all that shit, but I don't even know why they go on to that, because the fact is he just was better. And he should be better. He's a son. My son's better than me. My son's writing code right now upstairs. He's 11 years old and he's making films. So like,
wow,
that's evolution, right? Like that's what we want. The
true.
Human race wants better.
That is true. But that is a good point though, too. Like, you know, watching Robbie fly through the air, it was kind of, I mean, just magical, especially with the no hand jumps he would do.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought that up, because that's a big deal in history, right? He's not the first, but he's one of the first main riders to take his hands off the handlebars, and that can't be overlooked, but that was a big deal.
I only know is if you took your hands off an XR750 in the air, you would probably end up in a cemetery.
Yeah.
So, I think
true.
the evolution came with the lighter bikes and the more ability to, you know, flex that innovative muscle.
Exactly.
Because
exactly.
I can barely, you know, you barely, if you've ever been on an XR750, you barely want to push it off of a curb, let alone head towards a ramp with it.
Well, yeah. You're talking to a filmmaker who's never been on a bike before, so.
So make it want to inspire you to get on a bike?
No. Like flat out no. I mean, you know, it made me even. I remember on the jump day, I went out there at night and I filmed some stuff. And after we were wrapped, I went and walked the ramps. And I just thought my main thought was like, what kind of person does this for a living? Like, what is going on here? And you know, it's Robbie. Like, that's why I said earlier is like, they don't make them like that anymore, man. Like, these guys are, I know they're jumping big ramps and stuff now, and there's nothing to take away from all the greatness that they're doing now, which is amazing stuff, believe me.
Right.
But those ramps really set the tone for the mentality of the person jumping that bike.
Yep.
And Robbie's a special guy, you know, he's still alive. So we should celebrate him as much as we can.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Wow. Now, is this, you kept mentioning a broadcast. So is this going to be broadcasted on TV in September, you're saying, or?
Yeah, it's a Super Channel original series, which is a Canadian broadcaster. It doesn't have an American broadcaster yet. Netflix probably, who knows, right? Like that, I can't say that on air, but.
Right.
It's up to them. That's what their air date is. It's Super
nice.
Channel.
Nice. Yeah, I can't wait. Can't wait. It's going to be exciting.
Yeah, I mean, it's like Lathan knows better. He's watched them all. He's been a part of a lot of the films that have been made in the last 4 years. It's a different film. It sort of wraps the trilogy kind of thing, right, Lathan? Like,
yeah.
Daniel's film is different.
Yeah, they're all – I think they're all brilliant in their own way. And I was talking to Doug Danger and, you know, a couple other people and, you know, Rundle included and a lot of the family. This one is a lot more complicated in its own right, and it's special. I mean, I can, you know, it's a simple word to use, but I think that this is going to resonate heavily with people in general, a little more than fans of the brand or Knievel or any, you know, Daredevil, because it's just such a complicated, beautiful father and son story. You know, like Jesse, we showed it to, you know, Danny B. Harvey, our buddy, who, one of my best friends who contributed a lot of the rock and roll music to it. His wife, Annie Marie, knows absolutely nothing about Daredevils or anything. And she watched it and wrote me and just said it was riveting to her on a father and son level. And she's from a very complicated family as well, the Lewis, Jerry Lee Lewis family. And that's
wow.
The kind of beautiful, I think that's what's beautiful about this movie in its own way is if you know nothing about Daredevils or Knievels or anything, Jesse's told, you know, his own story, his own way. And I think that's the merit that needs to be applauded. I mean, I watch it every once a week now, maybe to get, you know, cause I had to walk away for a little while, as I'm sure Jesse had, but walk far away. But it's fantastic. I mean, it's just going to cross the lines. It's not about, it's a human condition story, a human condition between a father and son, a very, very complicated father and son relationship. So, to me, that's what's so beautiful about it.
But
now, was there a plane? I was going to say, was there
you're
a plane?
Crying?
No tears yet. No tears yet.
I cried last night. It was awesome.
Now, was there a plan all along to do a documentary on Robbie?
Yeah. I mean, the impetus came from. I was doing a short for a company on Snake River. And in the production meetings, I was always asking, we always ask for our interview subjects lists. And whenever I brought Robbie up, everybody's like, no, not going to happen, which I found intriguing. In the second meeting, in the production meeting, my partner who shot this film, Ken Johns, was with me. And same question came up, and I said, you know, as a director, I just said, hey, what about Robbie? And everybody in the production company said, nah, you know, not going to happen. So after that, I walked away with Ken, and we both looked at each other like, we got to look into this more. So we started, you know, digging in and found, you know, this, the kernel of an idea. And then, so it was always about Robbie. It was always about his life, but how do you tell a story? You know, one of the things that The Good Son that I did with Ray, it's not a boxing movie, but it's about a boxer. So I really wanted to make a film about father and son again, about a daredevil. So
that's
the impetus. It was always the impetus of the storyline. And it never wavered. We had that name, Chasing Evil, from day one. So I always knew what kind of film I was making. So and the people around me enabled me to do that, which I'm always grateful for, which is kind of a rare situation. And at the end of the day, you get the film that you started out making. I mean, you know, there's twists and turns, like you said earlier, but those are always there.
Sure.
You know,
yeah, when you first brought this up to Robbie, like, was he contemplating it, or was it an instant no, or?
He had been in development on this for years. I think that he got a bad rap, you know, and some of the shit he did himself and some of it he didn't. And I think he was really misunderstood. That's what I said earlier. So I just kept at it. I phoned him for 2 years before he returned my call.
Holy cow.
Yeah. I mean, I left him messages at the beginning every week. And then it was every month, and then it was every 2 months, and then it was like every 4 months, and then finally he called me back, you know.
Yeah, so I should be impressed. He got back to me pretty quick, huh?
Well, I think it's a different time. I think he's come a long way. I think this film is really indicative of rebirth for him. I think that he's seeing things. I think he's working through a lot of stuff, and I think that he's. Yeah, I pray for him. I pray for him a lot to make sure that he's all right. You know, like I care for the guy, and I think that when people see this film, they'll see a part of Robbie that is, you know, he deserves it. He deserves it. He put himself on the line in this film too, right? Like, it's not easy what he did. You know, whether he knew at the time or not. I mean, he spoke freely, and a lot of that stuff is hard for the family to hear, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, Evel's not alive to speak for himself.
So, but. Jesse, remember in Missoula, your main concern was, you know, I hope Linda likes the film, and
yeah,
she absolutely loved it. And it was, that was such a beautiful moment too, when she actually was like, oh, what'd she say to you? I didn't know Robbie was that famous.
but
she's such an angel. It's like, you know, yeah. Alicia was there, and Alicia and Tracy and Matt and the grandkids, and they all just adored the film. So that's pretty valid.
Well, I mean, Linda's fantastic in the film. I mean, she's just amazing. And you know, Alicia is fantastic, and Tracy is, and I thought Kelly was great. You know, so the family. You know, they're the reason why the film's so good, you know, Robbie especially, because I let Robbie talk as much as he possibly could about his own life. You know, so those are important points. And when you get back to the fact that you start out on a kernel of an idea, but it grows, right? Like Grandma Jean, who's in the film, she said some stuff, and I was just like, wow, what the? Like, I never thought that would that would come out of somebody's mouth, you know? So those are the things where it grows. That's the beauty of documentary filmmaking, is as long as you're resolute in your preparation, things grow and become amazing moments.
Now, did Linda see the movie yet?
Sorry? Yeah, she was at the premiere with us.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, that's who we were talking about. She, Oh, yeah, that's what you were talking about. Linda loved the film.
Yeah, the family just was, I mean, it was probably the most nerve-wracking screening I've ever had. And I could have not made it out of that city alive. But no, they were amazing, and we had a great time, and we talked a lot about it after, and I think it hit a chord with everybody. And that's the beginning of healing, really. You know.
Now, do you think from the person on the other side of the camera, making this film and seeing what went on between father and son, like the big story here, do you think deep down it helped Robbie at all deal with things and issues that went on over the years with his father?
Well, that time will tell. I mean, I think that Lathan brought that up earlier. I think it was a tough pill to swallow at first, maybe. I mean, it really kind of is an emotional film, but I think that from what I've seen, I can only speculate in the short amount of time from that screening to the next time he saw it to now, our relationship has gotten a lot better. You know, how he's dealing with it, I'm not with him, but when we talk, he seems really good. You know, better than he was when we started. It might have to do with his sobriety. I don't know. You know, like sobriety for him is the best thing that possibly could happen, is Robbie becoming sober. And he's kept it going for a long time. I mean, I'm not around him, so I don't know what happens in his daily life. But whenever I talk to him, he's pretty clear. You know.
Yeah, I agree with you there, though. Like, the last several months, he seems like he's pretty upbeat, and he sounds great. And it's been nice to get to know him again.
Nice. Very nice.
I'd be interested to see what he says on your show. No, I'm just joking. But
I think everybody's going to be interested to see what he says. I think he's even interested.
Yeah,
I talked to him an hour ago, and he sounded great. And I talked to Rundle, too. He's looking forward to getting on with you guys.
Yeah, those two guys are icons, man. Like, they're great guys. They're fun to be with. They're fun to make the film with. And I mean, yes, we had up and downs with everything, and production always puts stresses on people. But you know, we had at the premiere with Bill, he was great, and Lathan's been great, and it's really turned a corner since the release of this film.
Key word there is release. Let's release it to the world.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hey, I think I feel better. The more people see it, the less pressure is, the more pressure is released. I've shown it to a handful of really close friends, and the feedback makes me feel better and better and better and better. So I just can't wait for it to be completely out there. I think Jesse probably feels the same way.
Yeah. I mean, it's been a bit of a slow release, but that's always because of sales and political moves and stuff like that. But we're getting there.
I have a question for you, Jesse.
Sure.
Can you hear me all right?
I can, yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay, this is Henry. It's always been kind of a thing for me to watch Robbie. You know, because I'm a Daredevil, and I've really paid attention to his career. And it's always been a thing to me to know that he has trying to fill the shoes of his father. And, you know, we all know there's never going to be another Bruce Lee, never going to be another Elvis, never going to be another Evel Knievel. But in this, have you guys gotten a point across that there's never going to be another Robbie Knievel?
Yeah, oh yeah, that's the fourth act thing right there, man. I mean, I think that hits home. At least it did for me when I was filming. That's the reality. I think the jump in itself. I think you understand when you see this old guy of 54 jumping still. I think we all get it, literally.
Yep.
You know that.
Old guy
that was
jumping
at
50.
Yeah, no, but that was the reason why of seeing it full circle, right? is that, you know, we don't hit the nail over the head too many times in the film. It's not that type of film, but I think that, I mean, when he's putting those leathers on in the trailer at the end of the film, it's, people see it differently. For me, it was heartbreaking, man. It was like, this guy's still fucking going out there trying to make a living. He's 54 and he's jumping ramp to ramp. It's like,
with back surgery.
Excuse my language. Yeah, I mean, it's tough, man.
It takes a lot of courage.
I think Doug Klang said it best at the end of the film. He said, you know, you don't, if you can see it now, because it's going to end and it's all going to be gone with his retirement. Yeah. He said it way more elegantly than I just did.
That's it. You're done. You'll never see
what
it
was
again.
Your what
never.
Was your favorite part about the filmmaking process? What was the thing you liked the most?
Finishing it.
For me, it's always the friendships I make with the fellow passion victims, as I say. But Jesse,
yeah, no,
and
I mean,
really, really, really good pals. That was nice.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's that I would concur with that. I mean, the people you meet along the way, it's like you become family with, because it's you dig deep in these things, you hit the trenches, and it's there's a lot at stake at times. Sometimes it's financial, but a lot of the time it's just, you got to make this film, man. And the people become close. And Lathan has been amazing and a great sounding board for me to, you know, what do I, you know, he knows what I was going through, and it's been great. You know, I think I agree. That's the best part of the filmmaking process for sure. And finishing it.
And releasing it.
Okay.
and releasing it.
Okay, so what's the worst?
The worst?
Yeah.
The pressure of the. I don't think people understand the immense pressure that's on.
You know what? People ask me that all the time, because the coolest thing about filmmaking, I've done about 10 or 12, I think, but all on all levels, you go through absolute loss, hell, and absolute highs, all in one. And I wouldn't change it for anything. I mean, people think it's a joke, and it's, you know, the common myth is that, oh, what a great time you have all day long, when in reality, it's the hardest thing in the world to make absolutely something out of nothing and spill your blood and your wallet and your brains and, you know, everything. But I wouldn't change it, because it's when you're done, you've got this thing that's there forever that you've created out of nothing. So.
Well, and I would add to that, and I totally agree, and I think to add to that thought, I got to scoot out of here, guys, but my children are about to come home. You don't want to hear that. the reason why people love filmmaking and seeing films is a profound connection you can make with somebody's heart. And so it happened with The Good Son. It's happened with a lot of my films, where you really can change things, at least with the people watching sometimes. And it's when you see that happen in the theater or after. Like with Ray, for example, he didn't want to talk about Dooku Kim, man. He didn't want to have anything to do with it, right? But the film is about, at the end, about Dooku Kim's son who reunites with Ray, and it's the life-changing moment in the filmmaking process for everybody at that table. Believe me, it was life-changing for me. And there's moments in Chasing Evil which is the same, you know? And that's what you live for, and that's what you sacrifice everything for, are for those moments.
Well, I can't wait to see it. That's all I can say.
So me neither. I can't wait for you to see it either.
Then I can
but it was a pleasure. It was a honor to be on the show, and I thank you so much for your time. And yeah,
absolutely.
Lathan, you're still good in my books.
I just threw my book out the window.
Okay, guys.
Thanks, Jesse. Take care.
Okay,
thanks, Jesse.
Take care, guys. Cheers.
See you, Jess.
Wow, there he goes.
See you later, Canada.
calling in from the
Blame
Great
Canada.
White. Yeah, he's up in Vancouver, aka Hongcouver.
Hunk.
Well, no, it's such a quick trip from it's a shorter trip from Hong Kong, and it's I've been there a few times to work with him, and it's a thriving city. It's like they call it Hongcouver. They nicknamed it Hongcouver because it's anyway. Enough of that.
So now, Lathan, when you guys were doing this, was there anything that like came out of this movie that you didn't know that really like opened your eyes to like holy shit, like you couldn't believe this happened?
Well, I mean, the interview process is the most interesting. Well, partially the most interesting because really close people to Robbie and people in Butte that most people will never ever meet or be acquainted with, his really close friends who helped him through sobriety and things of that nature are all in the movie. And that stuff is always, and I knew these people, some of them beforehand, I'd met them at Evil Days or whatever, but I don't know. I have a lot of respect for Robbie because of his work ethic and you know, anybody should. The guy went out there and he kept the name going for so many years. And that's primarily what I walked away with it from. And also I became closer with him. There was a lot of, you know, misconception between, you know, business and what was going on and what I was doing and everything for a long time. And we finally had a really amazing conversation a few months ago. And, you know, it's just, I'm glad that things are improving and he sounds great and he's been through hell with his back surgery. He's had a couple of back surgeries and, you know, Rundle too. I've got a family in every state basically. So Butte, they're really special to me. The Knievels are, I mean, they've had my back through, I've been through a lot of stuff getting this, our museum opens in 2 months I got less than that now. It's going to be done in a few weeks, but you know, meeting Mike Patterson and the Harley Davidson guys here at Historic Harley and all the stuff that we've been through business wise, it's very parallel to what Evel went through, except I didn't jump. Doug jumped, obviously. Doug Danger's been jumping the bike but I just think that the complexities of Robbie's past and what he really went through being the son, that's part of my role in the film as a cast member is I think I say something like, you know, every kid wanted to be him, which we've all heard in all the films. But I just think I said, can you imagine being the son of that person? Just such a gigantic shadow. It's not like his dad was a plumber down the street, you know, drinking a 12 pack every night and hitting him with a wrench or, you know, just, there's a lot of people, there's a lot of complicated relationships in the world, very complicated, but I just think Robbie is in one of the most complicated father and son situations of all time. I really, really believe that. And he came out of it his own way and he made his own way and left home very young and started doing what he does. He jumped his ass off. So I don't know if that answers your question or not, but knowing the family really well has been an honor and a privilege, and I just loved every conversation I have with all of them.
That's awesome.
But now up next, you got Billy and Robbie. They can tell you the stories, man. They've been friends since they were kids. So
now,
yeah,
you mentioned it's coming along. It's almost done. So that's going to be huge.
Yeah, I just left there. I'm here now. I've put in about 6 hours today. We're doing tweaks. It's primarily finished. It's just fine tuning and it's just unbelievable. I can't even explain it to you. There's nothing worth even saying. It's so beyond. There's an interactive, basically you can sit on an XR750 on Evel's original ramp in the museum upstairs. You can sit on it with a virtual reality 3D system on your head. When Doug did his last jump here, he had six 360 GoPros on his helmet by Dimensional Innovations, and Mike Patterson kind of lined these guys up to do something that had never been done before. Everywhere you look when you're sitting on the motorcycle, you're on the motorcycle and you're basically Evel Knievel and Doug. I mean, the women that have got on it have screamed. Some people have thrown up. I mean, not literally, but no, you do an entire jump, practice runs, the whole thing, over the 15 police cars. And it's never been done. And that's just part of it. We've got an interactive broken bones display where there's three panels. You can pick a bone on Evel's body. This thing is so far beyond anything we ever imagined. I can't even really explain it to you, and I don't want to spoil anything. But it's not just a museum. And it's got a movie theater in there, a full-blown marquee 70s movie theater. Just besides the artifacts alone, you're going to just be mesmerized by it.
I guess you guys are doing like a premiere at the museum as well?
Well, the museum's going to show Evel Knievel, the Hamilton film. It's going to show Viva. It's going to kind of be a hybrid and an edited version of all that with 6 million with the Bionic Woman and, you know, the Sam Elliott thing. It's going to be kind of like a hybrid. So you can go in there on a loop. It'll have a time code and you can kind of watch what you want and leave. And then by the truck, we have a 20-minute documentary. It's part of the next film we're doing, Saving Evel, that we shot since the beginning. It's the last one. But Mike and Ryan Cavanaugh, this guy I work with, he's a brilliant, brilliant cinematographer and editor and visual graphics guy, digital graphics as well. There's a 20-minute making of the restoration of the truck that you can sit there and watch by the truck with the old skin of the truck. So there's a little viewing room there. But it starts from the beginning of his life all the way to the end, and panel by panel, every jump, everything. You can sit there for 10 minutes on one project and watch one jump and listen to one thing. And, you know, the Hutchinson jump, Wembley, LA Coliseum, it just goes all the way through his whole career. And we've got a lot of special artifacts that nobody has seen yet that we've been kind of hoarding till now, like his last suit that he ever used in Florida. And wow. there's a lot of new restorations on some of the motorcycles too. So it's just, I can't even explain it to you. I tried, but it's far more than a museum. I mean, it's just bananas. You could hang out in there all day. Please don't, but you could probably spend 8 hours in there, watch a bunch of movies. And we don't have popcorn though, because we'll end up ruining carpet.
Oh man.
Yeah. I mean, I try to get separated from it and come back, but I'll leave town for a week. And you know, this team, like Amanda, and there's like 20 people in there just kicking ass all day long. And sometimes I'm just kind of, I'm so in awe that I can't really wrap my head around it, but I'm just glad that it's getting down to the finish line now.
And the last time we talked about the beer. What's the update on that?
Yeah, we got the beer in several states now, and we kind of had a wee funder going for a little bit. So the next step is the light beer, Lesser Evel, which I think a lot of people are going to like, because, I don't know, craft beer is such a popular thing in Austin, Texas. But me personally, it gives me a headache in two sips because of the hops, I think. But yeah, the light beer is next, and we're just kind of going state by state. I just had a meeting with the guys a couple weeks ago, and, you know, the interest is still really strong. I wish we could get it out faster, but that's kind of the plan. That's the next phase, is to get it everywhere. It just takes a little time.
Everything takes time.
And Kelly's got some really cool stuff up his sleeve up in Nevada, and the pizza place is really doing well too. The Evel Pie.
So yeah.
Hopefully we get one of those cracking in Austin. And then I'm sure those will spread like wildfire too. From what I hear, it's doing really, really well.
That's amazing. Evel Pie,
yeah.
Evel Fear.
But yeah, I think everyone's going to flip out on this movie, because it's not like the other ones at all. And that's what's great about them all. Being Evel is incredible. It really focuses on Snake River a lot. And then it's dug up. Daniel dug up people that I've never even found, which I thought I'd found everybody. And Chasing Evil's got Kenny Brown in it. Kenny Brown, wait till you see this guy's interview. I mean, he was a key guy early on with Evel. He had you remember the electro cycle kind of era, early 70s. That thing was defunct. It was a Sun Machine, but this guy's came out of the woodwork and he lives in Arizona. And I said, Jesse, you got to interview this guy. And he flew over there and he managed Robbie right when Robbie kind of went on his own. And, you know, that's all explained in the film, but he's one of my favorite interviews. He's a total character, but it's its own film. It stands up. And like I said, it's more about father and son than, you know, there's plenty of Daredevil in there, but just imagine being the son of, I wish that was the poster. Imagine being the son of Evel Knievel. Cause basically that's what it's about. And Robbie took off and did his thing and he did it full scale and he did it his way. And I don't know. I have a lot of respect for him and hopefully people dig the movie.
You know, it almost sounds like too, like growing up, I don't know for Henry, but for me, like, you know, looking up to Evel as a little kid and idolizing him, then seeing Robbie and being the fact that my father passed when I was very, very young, in those Evel Knievel days, I would be like, oh, I wish Evel Knievel was my father. You know what I mean? And it's like almost on the flip side. Like, you wonder if
Robbie, man,
he was like, you know, a normal person.
Well,
a lot of that's
covered in the movie too. Like one of the cool scenes, we shot Robbie at the lot where the old trailer home was. And he talks about setting up his ramps in front of his house with his bicycle and how, you know, he had no choice but to jump his bike further than any kid in the neighborhood simply because his dad was Evel Knievel. And that sums it up right there. The guy got it in his head and he, you know, he went for it. I can't wait for Rundle and Robbie to get on, because Rundle's got stories that'll, I only know the last 5 years of extensively researching this stuff, but yeah, man, it's a really cool film. There's a lot of stuff in there people are never, you know, have never seen before as far as photographs and footage and especially Robbie's story.
Now, did you think it would come out, like, I mean, going into this, did you think it would come out, you know, this whole father-son story the way it did?
Yeah, well, I kind of did, because when I first met with Jesse, I jumped in with him and started helping him produce and then became executive producer with those guys. Was an honor. And then he wanted me to be in the film. And I was like, well, I don't, you know, I think you should interview Doug Klang and Doug Danger. And, you know, it's Rundle is a huge part of the film too. He's one of the main characters. Well, not characters, but we're all characters, but he's just been there the whole ride. He's been there since, I guess they were 5 or 6 years old. So, but yeah, Jesse is such a storyteller, and I think I pretty much knew he was going to go in his own direction, which is what a director does. And I thought it was, you know, amazing. It's not a highlight reel movie. It does have plenty of highlights, as he said, but it really gets down to the relationship, which, I think is going to be more appealing to everyone in the world rather than, it won't have a niche. I think you could put it on Netflix right now, and if it's promoted properly, have total strangers, you know, that have no clue what a Daredevil is, watch it and be like, holy wow. You know, I really just saw one of the most amazing father and son human condition stories I've ever seen.
Wow. Actually, I think one of the people you're talking about is actually on the phone. So I just looked up the area code and it's Butte, Montana. So, you know, it's somebody involved.
That is probably Mr. Bill Rundle.
I was saying, is this Mr. Bill Rundle?
Jesus, is that you, Lathan?
Hey, buddy. Yeah.
Welcome to TV.
There's the man I've been talking about, Mr. Bill Rundle.
How's everybody doing?
Doing good, Bill.
I'm great. We've just been making up shit since you got on. Now I can hang up.
I'll tell you, I've been listening, and I think it's done very well, and some great questions, and, you know, especially the way that the show was handled with Jesse and Lathan and the group of people we had that you know, everybody pretty much worked their ass off and really brought out something that I'm sure will blow everybody's mind to going back. I've been with the family for over 40 years, and to go back and see all this, you know, and remember it. It's pretty unbelievable. I can't wait for everybody to have the opportunity to see it and enjoy it.
Now, being the fact, Bill, that you were with the family for 40 years, was there things in this film that you didn't know had happened?
You know, back when he was very, very young, you know, maybe when he was 5 or 6 or something, you know, there are some things that, you know, that I wasn't around for, of course, there was some things that even surprised me. You know, we go back so far that it's just been an incredible ride. It couldn't hit any better, you know, with doing the show and then coming back and, you know, chasing Evel. You know, our dream, you know, was to go and jump the fountains at Caesar's Palace. And,
right.
And, you know, that was something that I'll never forget the day that I got the phone call and says, guess what? You know, we got a date. We're jumping the canyon. And we put a lot of work into it. I mean, not the canyon, excuse me, the fountains. And, you know, we had put a lot of work into getting set up for that jump. And I don't know, it that's where it all really began, you know, was Caesar's Palace, where, you know, you saw the changes of the difference between Evel and Robbie.
Right.
You know, was there jealousy, or, you know, there was just so many things that were coming into play, but it was one of them deals that you're happier than hell when it was over.
Wow. The thing, how about, like, did you ever consider writing a book, the things you probably saw through the years?
You know, I have a lot of tapes and you know, I guess I'd have to say that the majority of it, you know, is in my heart. You know, Robbie to me he's like my little brother.
Right.
And you know, I started racing, he started flat tracking with us when I raced, and you know, we turned him into not only, you know, can he jump a motorcycle. There's a lot of people out there that can, you know, they can say they can jump a motorcycle that don't even know how to do a wheelie. You know, and you know, you watch his talent as a motorcycle rider, and he's incredible. We used to ride almost every night, and you know, we rode our asses off. But he's just a very talented motorcycle rider, and I think that's why he did the things that he did with great success.
Yeah, that's the one thing you were saying. Like, some people don't even know how to do a wheelie.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny when you watch some of these guys, and they, you know, they come out and they're gonna jump 400 feet, and they haven't even done a wheelie yet. And it's, you know, it's kind of scary, but it's, you know, things have changed. You know, things are just aren't what they used to be. You know, if we had these motorcycle jumpers today that do it the same way Robbie does it, you know, it's a totally, you know, it's not even the same. It's not even the same game. You know, we're using, you know, the wooden ramps,
mm-hmm.
and you know, the degrees are different and the speeds are way different. You know, I'm not going to go through the miles an hour that we run and stuff, but, you know, it just everything has changed. And, you know, now the landing ramps are 30 feet tall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the takeoff ramps are 25 to 30 feet. You know, these guys are getting tremendous air.
Yeah.
And, you know, so they're going to go farther, of course, but it just things have really changed. And I'm glad we were able to, able to see it happen.
Bill, one question before I call Robbie and get along. Actually, brought up earlier in the show, and we were kind of wondering what the answer was, and it's a question I always wondered. Why is the takeoff ramp so thin?
Well, number one, you don't really need a wide takeoff ramp. I mean, four feet is plenty. I guess, you know, you really shouldn't be out there doing it if you're going to miss that 4-foot takeoff ramp. You know, go find something else to do, you know. But, you know, to the normal guy, I guess to us, after looking at it for all the years that we have, it's just it's normal. I've seen them even, you know, that they're thinner than that. You know, but it's funny, the older we got, the more that I'd be pushing, saying, you know, let's make that lantern ramp a little bigger. You know? I like the catch area a little bigger. That 4-foot takeoff ramp, I'm not too concerned about it. But that landing ramp, you know, like I said, as we got older, it really nicer to see a wider ramp. But Robbie's always been used to jumping in really tight places. And, you know, I heard you guys talking about the hay bales, and you know, they come into use, trust me.
I'm sure they do.
Yeah, I picked his ass out a lot of them.
All right, well, let's do this. Let's take a quick commercial break, and I'm going to call Robbie, get him on the line and set up. And,
hey, kids, and I'll say goodbye to you guys.
You there, Lathan?
Yeah, I just...
All right, brother.
All right, you guys have fun, and thanks, man.
Thank you, Lathan.
Thanks. I'll see you next week.
See you, Henry.
All right, everybody, stay tuned. We're going to be coming right back with the captain himself.
Attention business owners, website owners, event promoters, or anyone looking to promote your product. The Totally Driven Entertainment Radio Network is the perfect way to spread the word of your business around the world. That's right, you can advertise at our network and be played on all of our shows at rates that are so cheap, it's a no-brainer. For more information, contact Bay Ragni at bayragni@gmail.com. To keep your business driven, stay driven with Totally Driven Entertainment.
Are you a fan of Sherlock Holmes? Letters from Holmes offers unique, one-of-a-kind letters from the world-famous detective himself. Handwritten on 8.5-inch by 11-inch aged parchment paper and using smudge-free ink to produce original, high-quality letters that fans will treasure for years to come. Each letter is handcrafted and written from the perspective of Sherlock Holmes, mimicking Holmes's native tongue and embracing many of the famous detective's quirks, quips, insults, and peculiarities. Order a love letter, birthday greeting, personal correspondence, or more only at www.etsy.com/shop/lettersfromholmes.
For $5 today, you can buy a wealth of things. Gas for your car, rent a movie for the family, a few slices of pizza. $5 still takes you a long ways. But did you know that $5 can buy your child a bag of heroin on the streets? That's right. For only $5, your son or daughter can buy some of the cheapest and purest dope in the country. Be aware of the lies. Be aware of the stealing. Be aware that's all it takes to kill your child. $5. This message was brought to you by Casey's Cause, a group of parents located in southern Chester County out to save your child's life. Come join us today at www.caseyscause.com. And remember, $5 is all it takes. Casey's Cause, www.caseyscause.com.
Looking for that perfect gift for your girlfriend? Then look no further than Teddy Scares. Teddy Scares are available in a variety of styles, sizes, and prices for all your shopping needs. Teddy Scares are a mix of cute and creepy to make a great gift for almost any age. Board up your windows, lock your doors, and log on to TeddyScares.com. And be sure to become our friends at Facebook.com/TeddyScares.
Calling all comic book fans. Do you collect comics? Did you ever collect comics? Do you think your children might like reading comic books? Do you even know they still print real, paper, non-digital comic books? Well, then visit the Pirates of Ontario Street Comics in Philadelphia. We have a massive collection of comic books, action figures, trading cards, and much more. We have one of the largest stocks of back-issue comics in the area. We bag and board every new comic book at no extra charge. Our store is voted the best comic book shop in the 2013 PHL 17 Hot List Contest. Part of the movie Unbreakable is filmed in our store. We are open 7 days a week. Ontario Street Comics is located at 2235 East Ontario Street in the Port Richmond section of Philly. Our phone number is 215-288-7338. Type in the words Ontario Comics Philadelphia to check out our wacky stores page on Facebook.
This is Joey Kramer from Aerosmith, and I'm sitting here saying whatever the hell I please. And you're listening to Totally Driven Radio.
All right, welcome back to Totally Driven Radio, and we are in the middle of our Chasing Evil special. I got myself here, and Mr. Henry Rife, the Pitbull, the ATV Daredevil himself, as well as longtime Evel Knievel and Robbie Knievel family friend, crew member, the man himself, Mr. Bill Rundle. And on the line, waiting patiently, the man we're talking about, his ears have probably been burning for the last 90 minutes. Let's get him on the show, the captain himself, Mr. Robbie Knievel. What's going on there, Robbie?
Hey, not much, man. It's a lot earlier out here on the West Coast. So I'm doing good, but I got allergies. I'm coughing and can't breathe, and I don't know what's going on.
The trees
are leaking around here, man.
What's that?
The trees are leaking. A lot of things leak out, but you just don't want to tell anybody too much. You know, I'll just be a good listener, but I'll try and talk. Go ahead. Hi, Henry. Is Bill Rundle, my crew chief, really on the line?
Hello, Robbie.
Hey, Bill. How you doing, buddy? I love you, man.
I'm doing good, brother. How you doing?
Last time I talked, you didn't sound good.
I'm doing all right. Looking
forward to the documentary. Bill's on there a lot. He did a good job.
Well, thank you. I think the show's great.
I still like Rocky, though. I watch Rocky repeats all the time. I'll never forget the time I was in Philly. I was doing a jump, $10 million in cash for Delaware ING. And the owner took me on this ride to Philadelphia from Delaware. And we were late, and the cops were trying to get me to catch up to the other bikers. And by the time we caught them, we were downtown Philly. But on the way, we're doing 110 miles an hour on our Harleys. The cops are on their bike. And all of a sudden, this hard bag comes off the cop's Harley. And I'll never forget the cop next to me. They're mic'd, and we're laughing our ass off because the hard bag hit the highway and bounced into the center median. And then we're going, I go, hey, watch this. Here goes the next one. And about 2 minutes later, his second one vibrated off because you're going as fast as the cop Harley can go at 110. And it bounces down and misses us and hits the median. Then we caught up with everybody in Philly. But I'll never forget that. That was a blast. It was a big jump over the cash in the Steve Miller band. I jumped for it.
Yeah.
But anyway,
I was
to the owner of ING and all the cops in Philly, that was a blast.
Oh, that's too funny. You know, it's funny. I actually met you, Robbie, going back in time. It was around 788. You were doing an appearance at the World of Wheels car show in Philadelphia. And I went over to meet you, and I asked you, and I said, Robbie, what goes through your head, like, after you crash, like, that you're going to keep getting back on that bike to do it? And you were just like, you know what? I crash, and I say to myself, screw that. I'm done. I'm not getting back on that bike. And then I go to work on the construction site. I'm like, screw it. I'm done with this. I'm getting back on the bike.
Well, no. I got a new comedy act with my dad. I had two puppets made, one when he was 36 on Sports Illustrated and one when he was an old man a year before he died with oxygen and glasses on with his gray hair sticking up. And they're my two puppets because I was a ventriloquist. I bought a puppet when I was in my teens. So now I got this new show, and it's going to be at Seven Cedars Casino, May 6th, which is Saturday, coming up, next May 6th. And my birthday is the 7th. But my dad used to always say part of my act, get you, one of his jokes. Get your ex-wife in the car, going down the highway, put your leathers and helmet on, have her get going about 80 or 90, and when she hits 80 or 90, you have her blow the horn and you bail off, and that's what it feels like to crash.
Ooh.
So, you know, just for comparison. Anyway, that's you know, I got a lot of jokes in an All-American Story with me and my dad, and they're all true stories and funny jokes, and I can't wait to do this new act. It's going to be funny. But that's you know, I was always kind of a funny guy, but only my close friends knew that. So, you know, it's just, that's what I'm doing now. And I'm looking forward to the documentary. Me and my dad span 5 decades. And there's always a little kid that still wants your autograph because his dad and his grandfather saw my dad or saw me. So it's all perfect, you know. It's just, we work for it. We risk our life for it. And that's what my documentary, it's kind of hard in a way to me. I've seen it. It's kind of dark in a way. But it's the truth, you know. It's the truth. I've always been honest. My dad was always honest. And that's the way it is.
Do you think it was like going through this whole process of it was kind of like, because I know you've seen the final product. Has it been kind of like therapeutic in a way for you as well?
You know, I'm so used to the life I grew up with over the so many years. I've been in this business since I was 8 years old. That's like 47 years, 48 years. I mean, I'm going to be 55 next month and I'm still going off lamps, jumping 30 cars and breaking my back. I've had 2 major back surgeries in the last year since February of 2015. And it just, it hurts so bad. It cut me 12 inches all the way down my back. I mean, surgeries that people would turn down. And the doctor told me if you don't get these surgeries with crushed vertebrae and bad discs, and we don't put rods in there, we don't crush your bones into a cage, you are going to get back cancer and die. So I'm like, okay, I get it. Because my friend Grizzly Adams, Dan Haggerty, died of sarcoma back cancer. And back cancer can get you quick. And I woke up and I said to the nurse, did they go through my last incision a year ago? She goes, they went through that. They put another one on you that's about a foot long. So I've been pretty messed up with back surgery. My dad never had a back surgery. And I've munched my lower lumbars up or broken or cracked vertebrae, and they healed on their own. But when you have to get a major back surgery, it's bad. When you got to get chemo like my crew chief, when, you know, it's like everybody my age, they're pretty much either gone or they're dying.
Right.
And I'm going to live to the end, and I'm going to keep doing jumps and keep the name Knievel the most famous on two wheels because nobody can touch it. And I paid them dues, and I wanted to chase my dad. And I chased him, and I wanted to be just like him. And it took me a long time to realize I should have just stuck with golf. I could have just went out on the golf course and a nice green grass, and my wife would have left me alone.
Oh.
And he's a hell of a golfer, too.
I just played the other day. My back's so tweaked. It's been 5 months since my second surgery. But anyway, I'm just going to keep the name Knievel, the most famous on two wheels. Jesse James Miller did a great job producing this. Bill and all my friends and people that grew up with me, from my mother to my grandmother. My mother's still alive. She's an angel, which you can't find these days. And I'm happily single, and I'm still doing what I'm doing, and I'm going to keep jumping and keep living life the way it is, and I'm going to keep believing in the Trinity. God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, just like my dad. So you can take that, and that's how I'm going to be. And I'm going to keep signing every little kid's autograph because that keeps me alive, just like my dad taught.
Nice.
God bless you, Robbie.
When they came to you with the idea of the documentary, what did you think? Did you, like, instantly know, or did you, like, contemplate it at all? Or
no, I've had a couple people talk about it over the years, but Jesse James Miller, I knew did a friend of mine's documentary called The Good Son, Boom Boom Mancini, Ray Mancini. Mm-hmm. Who I used to hang out with in the late 80s. And, you know, all these guys have done boxing. All these athletes have done boxing. I am not done jumping. I am going to keep jumping, not to paralyze myself, I hope to God not, on purpose or anything, but unless I callus together and my back is as strong as it could be at 55 years old. But I put on a huge pyro show, 30-foot flame projectors, concussion bombs, and music, and you know what I have is meaningful, just like my dad. And that's
right.
Why me and my dad made it, and we appeal to the public, and we span generations. I mean, every guy that's been out there, they've done some really cool stuff, but I'm still old school. My dad was totally old school, and people don't get. I'm still jumping twice as high, twice as far, and hitting the pavement twice as fast. On a better bike, yeah, but I'm doing it twice as hard. They just say, well, Dad used to jump a Harley. Of course he did. But and he had the most balls of anybody in the world. But things progressed, and I stayed old school on the ramps, and I still hold the record for a legitimate jump contest off a 10-foot high ramp back in 1994. Everybody else that has gone farther. Anyway, I don't want to brag about that. I'm just still doing what my dad always did. And it shows the head-on steam engine train jump, the head-on car jump, and the Astrodome was thinking famous. The things I've done, the building-to-building jump, the pressure I've had on me with the live shows, I've done 8 5-hour specials. And I only did part of the Grand Canyon. You know, Fox
right.
always looked it up. Robbie Knievel, I'm going to jump the Grand Canyon. It's like, no, I'm jumping part of it. I would say that on my interviews. Because it really kicked me off when they lied to me. It was a huge jump. It was the longest jump I ever did over part of the Grand Canyon. Anyway, Pitbull, I want to say I love you. Bill, I love you in the spirit.
I love you, buddy.
And Faye, you sound like a great
love you,
guy.
Brother.
And I'm going to go get something to eat because I'm starving. Then I'm going to get back on the bus.
Well,
I love you, buddy. You hang in there.
Thank you.
You too, Bill.
Thank you for calling in, Robbie.
Take care,
and
Rob. Love you.
For the movie.
Hey, happy landings to everybody, and keep the faith. That's all we got. Life is short, man. That's why I'm bringing my dad back alive, so I can joke with him. Hey, you know what my dad would say? If you don't like me or me and my son, we paid our dues, so kiss my ass.
That's right. That's right.
Hey, Robbie, real quick. Before you go, can I just get you to say this is Robbie Knievel, and you're listening to Totally Driven Radio?
Hi, my name's Robbie Knievel, and you're listening to Totally Driven Radio.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Robbie Knievel, this is my dad, Evel, and you're listening to Totally Driven Radio. Yeah, keep it up!
There you go. That's a better one.
I don't know if he can keep it up unless he's got that super beta prostate, which is all bullshit. You got to take care. Love you, man. Keep on jumping.
Take
all
care,
right,
Robbie.
Take care, man. Bye-bye.
Love
Bye.
You.
All right, there he goes. The one and the only.
Well, wow, that was like a tropical storm.
He came
yeah,
in
Yeah,
he
likes to get in and get out.
So with the whole documentary, I mean, it must have been a tough interview process to actually for them guys to actually be able to interview Robbie and get into, because you can tell he likes to joke and get around and get in and get out.
Yeah, you know, it was difficult because, you know, we just had them problems up here in Butte and where he, you know, had to hit and run in the DUI, and I mean, he was going to jail, and you know, everything was taken away from him, and he knew if he made a mistake, you know, that he'd be in big trouble, and he did. So, you know, this interview or this documentary fell right into place because it shows, you know, what it was like for him to have to quit drinking and, you know, live a different life than he's been doing, you know, running for the last 35 years. So it was, I was so proud of him to watch, you know, how he transformed into a different person. He's out there one day and he's doing something to the bike. And I went over there and I said, what are you doing? I'm checking and jetting. I said, leave the bike. Get away from here. Just leave the bikes alone, you know. Just because you don't drink now, you're going to start playing with the motorcycles? I don't think so. But, you know, it was just, he's done so well, and we're all very proud of him. And I hope he, you know, I don't know if you've seen the pictures of
of his back. But I mean, if you ever saw it, it'd blow your mind because you wonder how the hell he can even walk, much less get on a motorcycle and jump. And I mean, this last jump that we had in California, I knew that we were going to be, that he was going to go long. And, you know, when he hit the hay, he went right between the hay and a rock and a cactus. And when I got to him and I finally got the helmet loosened up and I could talk to him, you know, at first he couldn't feel his legs. And, you know, right away I thought that, you know, that was it. And, but, you know, he got right back up again and he ended up walking up the ramp and, you know, he'll come back and he'll do it again. And I hope not, but I know how he is. So just going to be prepared and ready when it's showtime and you get the call and you know, it's time to get everything ready and hit the road again. I know it's coming. It's just a matter of time.
Now, that was the thing I was gonna, like, I heard from, you know, Henry, Lathan, yourself, how bad this, and even Robbie just now, how bad this back injury was. Do you think it's the smartest thing for him to still come back?
No, I'm against it because, I mean, when you see you see these rods and these screws that are snapped right off, you know, and it's messed up so bad that you know, he has faith and he believes that he's tougher than which he is. I mean, he's tougher than hell and. You know, he's not going to let something like this stop him, which does scares the hell out of me.
Right.
But, you know, I don't know. I it's hard for me to sit here after all these years and say, you know, it's over, because I know better. You know, there's been times I've thought that and I've wished that, you know, I thought, God damn, enough's enough. You know, especially after you just get done going at a train head on or miss your numbers on something like that. And you sit back and, you know, you put all the blame on yourself. And that's what's tough, you know, in my position, you know, doing the setup, you know, one little thing goes wrong, you know, you're going to deal with that for the rest of your life. And, you know, thank God he doesn't, you know, he never questions anything. He just gets on it and, you know, we can talk to each other, you know, well enough where, you know, all he's got to do is say what he feels and I can make the changes. And he goes out and does it. And he's just, like I said, he's such a talented bike rider that who knows when he's going to quit.
Wow. That's scary though. It is scary. But I, you know, I
yeah.
get it, but it's scary. Now, one thing too, like with Robbie is, like he never used a speedometer.
Like, right.
How the hell do you tell, like, you know, you've hit that speed. That's gotta, I would be so scared of that.
Well, you know, I guess the theory is, you know, you start running up above, you know, pushing numbers over 80, you know, and you're going at a 4-foot takeoff, you don't have a whole lot of time to be looking down to see how fast you're going. And, you know, our deal is, you know, we know, you know, by gearing and by the jetting and the gearing and the, you know, we know how, you know, and radar guns and, you know, we know how hard to push the bike and he knows, you know, where he has to be and what gear. And that's how he hits it. You know, is there a lot of people still to this day that say, I can't believe you don't use it. You know, the jumpers that still use speedometers. And, you know, it's okay. I worked with Lorenzo Lamas one time and was working with him, teaching him how to jump. And, you know, it was really what I did there is I just put some pylons down and, you know, he'd run 55 miles an hour between these two pylons, and once I got him up to that speed, you know, all he had to do was just keep it steady there, and, you know, and he'd make it over 100 feet. And so, that you know, there's still these guys out there that do use the speedometer, and it's just something that we never really ever felt comfortable with.
Wow. Now, did you ever in your life have the desire to want to jump?
You know, I was not really. It just I was a Northwest champion in the expert class flat track racer. I had a ride with Yamaha, so my life was, you know, was flat track, dirt track racing. And, you know, so my goal was always, you know, try to get that number one plate. And, you know, when it can't come to the jumping end of it, it was, you know, leave it to let him do that shit. You know, I watched too many times and I saw too much, you know, I was like, God damn, you know. And, you know, I've gone off jumps, but I've never, you know, I'd never, is it something I ever wanted to do or that was ever in my, no. You know, because I understand it probably as well as anybody. And I just, it's just something that, I don't know, I just felt a lot better on a dirt track than I did with all the wheels off the ground, I guess.
Hey, Bray.
Yes.
Hey, how you doing, Bill? This is Henry. Hey,
Hey, Henry. How you doing?
Hey, I have an interesting bit of trivia for you, Bay, that I know Bill doesn't know. I'm going to pull this out, but imagine a live Fox broadcast, and Mr. Rundle is the only person I know to be on live Fox TV, network TV all around the country, and get away with saying motherfucker four times.
Jesus, I don't remember that one.
You don't remember that?
There's
a 30 limo jump. Robbie makes it, and you run up and hug him, and you start saying that motherfucker over and over, and it's a lie, and they didn't catch it. I thought that was awesome.
Yeah, that was a long ways, and, you know, that whole week was a tough week because of the rain and the – you know, that the winds and, you know, the 30, you get the 30 limos lined up. That was a long way. And, you know, that was another deal where we knew we didn't have enough room to stop. But, oh, yeah, I'm sure I say it a lot. I just, I'm not conscious of it anymore. I'm probably even worse. I've dealt with it. Bobby was talking about the chemo. I've been through colon cancer, and then I just been through several major strokes.
Oh.
So I just I blame the strokes on Robbie. other than that, you know, it's just you just go a day at a time.
Well, growing up with Robbie, you got to tell us some good teenage Robbie Knievel stories. You got any? I know you got thousands.
You know, there's so many of them. Probably, I've got so many of them. When he was young, he was just a handful. And his dad bought him a brand new van. I'll never forget it. And they weren't getting along. And so his dad buys him a brand new custom van. So he goes and picks these two gals up, and he takes them. Going to take him duck hunting at 3 o'clock in the morning. And ends up rolling the van over in a ditch in a creek. So in order to stay warm, they tore every bit of the interior out of the inside of his van and wrapped themselves in it until someone finally came and they put it back on his wheels. And he pulls up in front of my house, and I almost shit. I went out there, and here's this brand new van. With duct tape and cardboard where the windows were, there wasn't a seat, headliner. He tore the whole thing to shit. And I thought, you know, how are you going to explain this one?
know, I thought, I'm glad your old man's down in Florida. That's all I can say. But I've seen him do some of the, just some, you know, he wasn't afraid of anything. And it's funny how the music store got robbed here several times. And I watch him do it. In fact, he borrowed a tire iron. And I wonder what the hell is he doing. I just have him be parked out there. He knocks the window out, and they go in there, and they rob it and get busted. And then he did it a second time, knowing he could get away with it. And the judge told him, said, Mr. Knievel, if I catch you, if you rob that store again, you are going to go away, and it's not going to be at a girls' school where you just came from. You are going away, and you'll see what 5 years is like. You got that, Mr. Knievel? Robbie said, yes, sir. He said, all right. And then Robbie says, then I goes, I don't know. He said, I heard a couple years later it got robbed, but I don't know nothing about it. You know, and it's like, yeah, goofy. He goes, that's where him and his dad are a lot alike.
I read a story once about, and maybe it's about what you're talking about, him robbing a store. He got busted, and him and Evel got into it, and he ended up having to get some plastic surgery over that confrontation. Is that true?
He actually ended up going to my mother and father's house, and Evel had, he kicked him right in the face and smashed his nose, and yeah, it was a real bad deal. And my mother and father wanted to take custody of Robbie. You know, at the time he was probably 15 years old. And it was, here's cop cars around the whole block, and the Ferrari, and Linda's in the Lamborghini, and the war's on, and I mean, it was just, Robbie, you know, the thing that you'll get out of this show is you'll find out about a guy that, you know, just because his name was Robbie Knievel, Robbie did everything on his own. He had no help from no one, you know, he did what he did on his own. And, you know, for that, you know, there's a lot of people who live off their father's names, or, you know, they try to follow their past. But, you know, Robbie did it, you know, he was a lot better bike rider, and you know, he did it all on his own.
Right.
And so that I'm pretty proud of, you know, that his accomplishments in life were awesome there at a young age, and I can't believe that we're this old and still think about that stuff. But anyway,
which jump of Robbie's are you most proud of?
I'd have to say, you know, I like the 30 limousines because of the view of it. I mean, the length and everything was incredible. But I think the one that took a lot out of me, which was tough, was the train jump, because it, it came on so fast. Matt Millen was working for Fox, and I was doing an interview, and it's like, you know, that's the last thing I really want to do is an interview, and we're starting the bike, and we're getting ready to jump this train, because the train's, you know, it's on its way. Well, it's
right.
A steam engine, and you cannot, you know, you can't dial in a steam engine. I mean, it might run 29 one time and 31 the next time.
Right.
So, you know, you're doing your math, and you're trying to figure out, you know, exactly where you got to be as far as gearing and everything. And I sent him, you know, I knew where we had to be in. So I went ahead and told him, go. Well, when he did, I noticed the bike spin, and he had to get out of it and get back in and get out and get back in until it hooked up good, you know, so he lost a good quarter of a second anyway, and I'm just like, oh, fuck, he ain't going to beat that train. And what had happened was he was so, you know, he was so pumped up to get after that train that, you know, he was revving it up and hold it wide open. Well, it had got warm because, of course, it's not moving, and, you know, the radiator's not getting any air through it. And
and it spits some antifreeze out on the plywood. So the minute that rear tire hit it, it just started spinning like hell. And once he got it over, you know, then he pulled off. If you watch, he pulled off onto the dirt and bricks, and then it went right for him. And, I mean, I don't know. It might have been a quarter of a second. It was, you know, that one there was, I just remember walking away from that one saying, I'm done. I can't do this shit no more. You know, I've had enough.
How about the building one?
Building was another tough one because, you know, it was bad enough to have to get up on the building itself. But then to build that big ramp off the back of it, I'm telling you, there was only a handful of people, you know, and I'm talking two or three that would even walk up down where he was going.
Sure.
You know, we our big thing was, you know, you can't afford to miss a gear. You know, the whole thing there was, you know, that you had to be right on. So he actually hung the front tire over the top of that ramp up above and got it into third gear and let that thing start spinning up above when we were ready to send them. And so we just got the tires spinning until it was hot as it could get and sticky. And then he just started slipping the clutch and started down it and just held it wide open.
Wow.
So, you know, you didn't have the factor of having to shift. And, you know, if you were to miss a gear, you know, you were in deep shit. But that was another one that I was so happy to see over with. I don't know. It's been a hell of a ride. I've been very fortunate to do what I've done. I know that, and you know, the Knievel family is pretty much my family, and I love them all. And I can't wait for everybody to see this documentary. I know it'll blow your mind, and I guarantee you will shed a tear.
Wow. Yeah, that was one of my questions I asked to Jesse James Miller, if they think people will be shedding a tear to this film.
Yeah, you know, I know every time my wife has seen it, and the times that I've watched it, I have, you know, because it is. I mean, there's some dark things in there. You know, like I said, Robbie did everything on his own, and you know, when you think back. When you were 15 years old, if you could have handled what he did, you know, he was pretty much on his own. And, you know, it's been a great ride. That's all I can say.
Well, Bill, I want to thank you so much for calling in and hanging out with us and telling stories. And it's been an honor.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much. And, Henry, good luck to you.
Thank you, buddy. I appreciate it.
Hopefully, you know, we can talk about one more jump in the future someday.
Well, according to Robbie,
absolutely.
We will. So I guess we'll talk on it again at some point.
Yeah. All right. Well, sounds good. Good luck and God bless.
You too, Bill. Thank you, buddy. So
thank you.
Okay. You bet. Bye-bye.
Bye. All right. Well, there he goes. Mr. Bill Rundle. And actually, we have somebody who's been waiting patiently on hold, and I'm not sure who it is. Let's find out. You're live on the air. Who's this?
It's Mike Draper.
Mike Draper. How are you?
Draper!
How you doing, buddy?
Well, I'm listening to all these good guys in here. I'm sorry I missed Robbie. I was listening to him talk about where he had to go and stuff, and I was listening to Bill and stuff. Just listen to him too. Pretty interesting.
You know, I'm glad you called in because when we first started talking about this, I was hoping that you were going to call in for this because I wanted to know like a point of view from somebody like you who was around, you know, in them early years when Robbie was a kid and, you know, what was it like seeing Robbie grow through the years?
Well, I think statute of limitations is probably still keeping me from saying a lot of things about him. There's a lot of stuff that he had. See, I was probably 20, 21, and he was probably 15 at the time. And like Bill was talking about, he was a handful and stuff, and they definitely knew him in the town, and he was pretty ornery. I used to take him and his friends up to snowball at the go skiing all the time. They were all avid skiers and stuff, and he was great on skis, and just like he is on motorcycle. But he did run through a lot of stuff. He's had a couple of things where he has gone through, and his dad was out of town, and I happened to be in Butte, and I kind of got the deal to, if I could kind of help him along at the house or help him, you know, kind of watch over him and stuff. And
right.
But, he definitely liked the party and stuff. I do remember those guys like Annie Greensprings. We used to go to campfires and stuff, and he liked that. And I can't think of the Annie Greensprings had several different deals of wine and stuff. Maybe I'd like to drink that. It was pretty nice. It was a different deal. I mean, it's I can see where Robbie had a lot of stuff to live up to, and you know, you didn't do it just like your dad. Well, you didn't. Your dad. How can we going to be like your dad? You know, just you know, on and on. So he had a lot of pressure. So
yeah.
But
you know, it really sounds like, you know, you always hear when people talk about Elvis, you know, the Memphis Mafia, but it really sounds like there was, you know, like a Butte Mafia with the Knievel bunch and you guys.
Yeah, it was kind of deal. I mean, when he come to town, you know, he pretty well, he took me a tour of all the beer joints downtown and stuff, and introduced me to all his friends, and that's about what Butte was for a long time, was just every other block was beer joints to be into, and I guess they had a lot of prostitution towns in there for all the miners and stuff. And it's an interesting town. I mean, it was. I took a tour of the mine before they closed it up, the Anaconda mine. Got to go down to the mile, and with about 10 other people in an elevator, went down the mile and look at the mines down there where those guys worked all the time, and took a lot of tours there, stayed at the War Bonnet Inn. I don't think that's there anymore. Like I said, you know, I took Robbie a lot of time, him and his friends and stuff. We'd go hunting and took him skiing quite a little bit. And they tried to teach me how to ski and stuff. And they could put a ski on my back, I'd have been successful. But pretty interesting. It was quite a little devil in my life because I was, like I say, I was 20, and those guys were a lot younger than I was and stuff. And I did go to his Robbie's jump out there in Las Vegas when he went over the limousines and got hooked back up with air. Before then, Evel had jumped at this Kansas State Fair back in like in 71. And Robbie, quite a few years after that, him and Bill came to Hutchinson, Kansas, and Robbie called me and asked me if I'd come over and kind of be on his pit crew and stuff. And it was pretty interesting to come back, and he jumped at the State Fair like his dad did. And that's where it kind of run into that, where it's always kind of small being back in Kansas, where the museum's at for Evel is Mike Patterson was up in the stands, and he was only 5 years old.
Wow.
So, I mean, he owns the Harley-Davidson place in Topeka, and he's got the museum and stuff. So it's just really kind of a small world here in Kansas. You know, Evel started out with Joey Chitwood and a lot of his stuff. There's a guy that owns the Cadillac pickup. He's in Eureka, Kansas. And then Lee was from Kansas. I was from Kansas. It just, the Kansas connection's been pretty strong.
Wow.
But, yeah, Robbie's done a lot. I mean, I was really impressed with it, you know, like that building to building, and I'm sure Bill was probably wrecked after watching all that stuff. And I thought he'd say something about jumping at the end of the Grand Canyon. I thought that was in the middle of the deal, it started snowing. how that weather changed up there was just unbelievable. If it didn't blow wind, it was snowing, and I bet Bill was just as nervous as Robbie was on that deal.
Now, watching all that stuff over the years, like, you know, being the fact that you were there, you know, through the evil times, and then you're seeing Robbie do this stuff, and I mean, you know, you're jumping building to building, piece of the Grand Canyon, all these crazy – what were the thoughts that really went through?
Yeah, there was it was quite interesting that Robbie took on that and did quite a little bit. But, you know, like I said, Bill was probably a lot more closer to that, but I had Linda and Tracy and Kelly and everything. I mean, Robbie and Kelly rode with me and Lee in the truck one time. We went through the Royal Gorge and went through there, and just a regular couple of kids that wanted to do some stuff. We took them all to her there because there was a lot of time that their dad didn't have time to do that. And plus, being in a celebrity status he had, you know, they really didn't get to do a lot of stuff.
Right.
With their dad and stuff. So, but Robbie and Kelly, you know, they came, rode in the performance. You know, he'd introduce them, and you could see him in some of their pictures that Robbie was a good wheelie, you know, and kind of wheelied with his dad most of the time. Kelly didn't do a whole lot of this stuff. He just wasn't that interested in doing that. And Kelly was, or and Tracy, I'm sorry, Robbie was. Robbie really liked to do all of that. And so I think it kind of bounced off it, and he really wanted to impress his dad, and he did.
You know, that's, you know, the person who really gets no mention at all, very rarely does get brought up, is Kelly. And I'm sure there's a whole other story there as well.
Well, there is. I just, Kelly just wanted to take a different path, and he has. I mean, he does some stuff now that he helps kind of promote the brand and of Knievel and stuff. But he really jumping the motorcycle wasn't his thing. It just wasn't, you know, he was a lot more shy than, well, Robbie was never shy. So right. I'd have to say that Kelly was more of the shy person, and kind of the background, and just really didn't have any inclination about jumping or doing any of that stuff with the motorcycles. He did because his dad wanted him introduced on the deal, and he did do some stuff. But if you ever see Robbie with his dad and Kelly, you can see Robbie is the one out in front doing all the wheelies and back and forth. Evel could be pretty intense. You know, he wanted his boys to really shine in doing that, and doing so, you know, with like, can't you do anything right or something? I mean, he was pretty intense.
Did you ever see Robbie as a very young boy and think to yourself, he's going to be better than his dad one day?
Well, I knew that Robbie, if he stayed with it, he was going to be, because he was already jumping with the motocrossing and doing a lot of that stuff. And being that young and stuff, you know, being invincible, I'll never be hurt, you know, and there's lots of stuff he'd do that just would blow your mind. I mean, that's he started doing things on his jumping and stuff that his dad would have never done. And but it's just that he did a lot of stuff on his own. I mean, his dad tried to help him on some of his stuff, but that's where they clash on a lot of stuff. You know, I know how to jump. You don't have to tell me how to jump. And, you know, it just it was kind of hard on him about doing this, but I'd really thought that Robbie is going to, you know, outshine his dad on it. And he did do that on wheelies. He did that on a lot of stuff that he outshined his dad on. But his dad had a short temper with him on a lot of stuff.
Did you ever, like in the last couple shows Robbie did, the big stuff before Evel passed, you know, they'd always cut to a picture of Evel watching, and he just had this look of pure dread on his face, like, you know, I created all this, and my son might end up dead, and I'm kind of responsible for this. Did you ever see that, or you know, hear Evel talk about that?
Yeah, you can see him. He really didn't. I don't think he wanted Robbie to get quite this far into it. I think he wanted to show him off and stuff, but I don't think he wanted to get into that business because he went through all that stuff. And I think you can see that in his face when they Robbie did Caesar's Palace. He was pretty gloomed through the whole thing, and he was not happy with it at all because he'd seen all those other writers, you know, crippled for life and stuff, and then almost him, almost did him in. He just, he was so glad that he made it at the deal, you know, did real well, but you could tell he was on pins and needles when Robbie was going up there. I mean, you know, he was trying to tell him, you know, oh, you got to do this, you got to do that. Robbie said, I already know that, I know that. And I'm sure the tension was pretty heavy duty there. But Evel's got a terrible look on his face like that could happen. It could. It could have happened very easily, but he definitely was not really enthused that he was going to do that. But Robbie was headstrong and said, I'm going to do it. So, and I'm glad that he did it and did it pretty well. But Evel was just really uptight about that.
Yeah, it looked like somebody was walking over his grave when they was interviewing him. And, you know, me and Bay talked about this earlier. A lot of times, even me, you know, I don't jump the distance as Robbie does, but, you know, people walk up and they act like it's a joke. Motorcycle jumping is no joke, and you can die just in a matter of seconds. And, you know, people don't take that serious. I've fallen off and, you know, broke a shoulder, and people walk up, slap you on the back, and you wince, and, oh, you're really hurt. Well, no shit. I just fell off a four-wheeler 65 mile an hour and hit the pavement. They have a disconnect. They don't see that as real. And I always watch, you know, that look on Evel's face, and that, you know, I could not imagine as a parent having my son go out there and do that, knowing that I'm the reason he's doing it, and he could die.
Exactly. You know, and if not kill him, it would just cripple him for life and stuff, and you'd live by that with the rest of your life about that I did that. But I always did. If I ever got a wild hair that I thought I'd need to jump or anything, I'd just walk up to the takeoff ramp, look across there and said, nope, go back to setting them up and push these motorcycles around for him. So, yeah, you get somebody to walk up that ramp, I'm not kidding you, it looks, you know, oh, man, that was kind of easy. Oh, man, he went right across there. That was no big deal. But you walk up the end of that or go up the takeoff ramp and look across there, man, that's just unbelievable. And he had to look at that each time he going across there. Oh, Robbie does and psychs himself up, and you do. you're like, God, there's got to be an easier way to make a living. Wow.
Yeah. I would not. That's true. That's true. I always wondered, like, what Evel or even Robbie thought, like, about, and this is no offense to you, Henry, but other daredevils, you know, especially back then, like, coming up in the 70s that were trying to, you know, do the Evel Knievel thing, like, what they thought, if they thought of them as, you know,
well, there's stories about this, where Evel has, like Johnny Airtime, you know who Johnny Airtime is. He's actually, told me stories about Evel, taking him to court so he couldn't jump at a certain place. And it was purely, you know, professional, I guess in this case, this courtesy. He just didn't want any the Knievel glory, and they were pretty cutthroat about it. Now I have an advantage over a lot of these guys because I don't do the same thing. I jump with a four wheeler, they jump with bikes, so I'm not really stepping on their toes. I do wear the outfit and that, but and Robbie laughed and he told me, he said, "You're like the third Knievel." And look, there's no better compliment I could ever get. But I really don't do the same thing those guys do. And, you know, Evel and Robbie didn't do the same thing. Evel did it with a Harley.
Right.
A big, heavy, awkward piece of crap. And Robbie did it on a CR500. And I owned a CR500, and I jumped it plenty of times. I jumped one over 170 feet. And when I did it, I realized that wasn't for me. It wasn't that it really scared the hell out of me or anything. It's just that is being done by somebody already. And I'm just going to end up a copycat, and I didn't want to be that. So, and I've heard stories of Robbie doing similar things. But, you know, like that, a lot of these, as we've experienced on your show,
mm-hmm.
a lot of these daredevils are they get kind of petty. I've never had a bad thing with Evel or Robbie, so I can't comment on that. But a lot of these guys are very competitive, and they're completely junkies for the limelight. So,
sure.
You know, friendships could easily be ruined over hardly anything.
You know, it kind of reminds me of like the wrestling business almost kind of too with situations like that.
Well, had dozens of people out there, you know, with all their personas. I mean, it's very much like professional wrestling.
Yeah.
You know, people think that wrestling is a joke, but it's not a joke. The injuries are real, and they really have to be good athletes. Well, it's the same thing with jumping. People take that as it's a put-on. Oh, he's not really hurt. The hell they ain't.
Yeah, right.
Look, I've done this for almost 45 years now. I've been jumping, and I got to tell you, there's nothing I love more as an activity or a thing to do. This is what I was made to do. But, you know, that shit hurts. It's real. And, you know, it's easy to put your finger and say, oh, I can do that. But unless you're out there actually doing it, you need to shut the hell up.
Yeah. It's true. You can't really, if you haven't done it, you have really to speak it.
And silence. This is, you know, motorcycle jumping is thrilling. Even after all these years, it's thrilling. But, you know, you see these guys, the Monster energy drink sponsored guys that go off a 40-foot ramp. And, you know, Jason Bird, as I said, he jumps 500 feet. He's 92 feet. In the air at the apex of his jump, 92 feet. He's twice the height of a telephone pole. Are you kidding me? That's not the same thing.
How about Mike, I guess you would probably know this answer possibly. Like when you mentioned them earlier, who was it, Gary Wells? When he tried to jump the fountains, and which I think his crash might even be more horrendous than Evel's at the fountains. What Evel's opinion of that was, or even Robbie's opinion?
Well, there was lots of stuff with it, you know, in the windows at the somebody moved his ramp and moved the ramp away and. There was a lot of stuff that they thought that that they had done that. There was lots of rumors going around that somebody moved the ramp up, you know, and tried to do in these jump. And, you know, it got pretty competitive back there doing some stuff. And it's like anybody else that says, oh, I can jump farther than Evel and I can do this. And but it was always kind of a compliment because for you to get ahead about doing this, you'd have to say that I did something better than Evel Knievel, because that was the thing to do that. And pretty soon, you know, Evel was like, well, I got to come up with something different. I got to be a little further. I got to do something like that. But it finally realized to me, he says, I don't have to jump, you know, 200, 300, 400 feet. You know, I do my stuff. I do my show. And that's one thing about it. Evel put on a show. He just didn't come out there and say, I can jump over that. And everybody kind of went home. He always had a little, you know, let me warm up my motorcycle or do some wheelies. And the jet bike, he added that to it. Later on, he added his dragster, you know, added to the show to do that. And then he always had a little spiel about to him about kicking kids off the drug. You know, and then he come up with a deal about, you know, when he jumped the canyon and he'd keep his word and, you know, just all of that stuff. It all worked together, you know, to make it a whole show together. It wasn't just him coming out there and jumping. He had a message to tell, and he always had something different to do. Like I said, they saw the jet bike and they saw the big truck. I mean, there was just, he liked to entertain people about doing some stuff with it. He did real well. Then when he tried to drum up some business about when he did that, I don't know what he was smoking in that day, but when he was talking about jumping in that haystack, that just, I don't know. We had, you know, painted, that time we changed the paint on the truck and put the big haystack on the side of the truck. And he was going to do that. And somebody finally that was experienced in skydiving doing something said, you're nuts. You said, you've not had any experience in doing that. But what was amazing, they said, oh, you couldn't pick the haystack. They were trying to get the Las Vegas dude bet, which we stacked to go into. But you know what's kind of weird about that? You know, and they were talking about jumping in a haystack. He got killed. There was a jump here, and I can't remember the guy's name, but it was pretty impressive where they went up almost into outer space, and he jumped off, and he landed in this big spring net like you do at the circus, you know, when you fall off the D-list.
Yeah.
That was pretty impressive. And I thought, you know, and he had to do that. He had to pick that a certain place when he landed. I kind of thinking, I said, you know, this is kind of a haystack reenactment here about him falling into that, and he survived it.
That jump is crazy.
You bet that was. I mean, but that was the same thing that Evel was talking about, jumping out of, you know, an airplane pretty high, and then he was going to have like 4 or 5 haystacks, and you got to guess which one he was going to jump in, big bets and whatever it was. But this guy here, I think, has practiced a little bit more than what Evel was of jumping out of airplanes and doing stuff. And the distance he went up in the air,
120,000
being in the space when he jumped off, and
yeah,
a lot of, but to hit that net, that probably looked like a head of a pin when he was coming down.
Sure.
And beyond that, that was just totally amazing.
I don't even know how you would come up with that and then figure out how to do that.
Exactly. I mean, that's. It was just one of the other deal, like I say, with a haystack deal. They finally convinced him that'd be way, lots of stuff to do. And I can't imagine what this guy spent on that jump. That had to be astronomical for what he did. But I'm sure he's making it back on a lot of movie rights and a lot of movies and stuff on that. But that was plumb crazy. But
absolutely.
Evel was a pioneer. You know, a lot of different stuff like that. You know, he jumped the sharks, and now every major media organization is jumping the shark.
Well, he's a promoter. I mean, he's he knew how to promote himself. That's the biggest thing about it is, you know, everybody says snake bull about doing this, but, you know, to show somebody up, you got to promote yourself, and that's what he did. Like I said, they still use him for a lot of stuff, you know, in movies and sayings when somebody wants you to do something. Like, what do you think I am, Evel Knievel?
Yeah.
You know, they,
who else has got a name like Evel Knievel? I mean, that just rolls off the tongue.
Well, see, that's another thing. You know, we had a persona about doing that. And you know Earl Castine, you know, good friend of Evel's, about doing, so talking about that one day, and he said, you know, this guy was rubbing shoulders with all the big name celebrity stars and wild world of sports, and I mean, everybody knew who this was. He's on Johnny Carson, and he's a motorcycle jumper. Wow. You know, that's just unbelievable. He actually made that, you know, that motorcycle jumpers were important, and, you know, as part of a sport, so you know, he created that persona about doing it, but he just, we talked about that several times. It's just, you know, he started out as just a motorcycle jumper, and then all of a sudden, this is this crazy guy at Caesar's Palace that looks like a rag doll coming down the ramp. You know, it's too bad he got killed, and they go, no, he lived, he still does this, and I'm like, he does? Wow.
That's, yeah, I was going to say, when you look back at that now, too, I think you brought up a good point. You know, recently with Don Rickles passing away, you go back and you look at them old Dean Martin roast, and there's Evel Knievel. You know what I mean? Like, he truly crossed over to
Donnie and Marie.
Yeah, like a side that nobody ever would have thought of.
The Bionic Woman.
What, a Bionic Woman? Tony, Telly Savalas. Bob Hope, he played in all the Bob Hope golfing tournaments. Frank Sinatra, he kind of, not really a true, you know, where they've seen him a lot, but he talked to him and, you know, they did.
Now,
stuff.
I have an interesting question about what we're talking about right now that ties in with Robbie. You seen, you know, there was a couple like Chips TV episodes that Robbie was actually in. Why don't you have any idea why he really didn't take like Evel did?
Robbie's not a good promoter. I hate to say it, but he's not. He doesn't promote himself well. He's kind of coming out of his shell. It sounds like when I was listening to him, he's excited on what he's doing and promoting himself to doing it. But it, I don't know. It's that is one thing. I don't know how to say it. It's hard to do because Evel come up with lots of schemes to get himself, you know, put his name up and doing it. Like if they call that hotel, use different names and, you know, to get them interested in doing that, you know, like, who did this guy? What is it? I guess it's just kind of like they have a service now that you can hire the paparazzi to follow you around town and take pictures and everything. And make people think of who we are. And that's kind of what Evel did, is he made himself important. I don't know how he, you know, it's weird how he did that, a motorcycle guy that did that, but he had all the right people. And, he had the right guy taking the pictures there, and his wife, Linda, at the Seeker's Palace. I mean, there's some big names right there. He got a couple of big breaks and stuff on it. And once you got in there, they wanted to have Evel Knievel at the jump. And pay good money for it. I mean, that was the biggest thing that he had to get them to convince them that, you know, he wanted $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 to do that. And they said, well, if you want a big thing, that's who you hired, and that's how much it's going to cost. And, you know, he'd tell them, he said, I'm going to pack the stands. And he usually did that. That's the same way when Hugo did that when he promoted him here at the Kansas State Fair. He said, I'll pack that place. And everybody's like, yeah, yeah, right. And in fact, the state board, or the fair board, the guys that put him on, he thought, yeah, here's a guy on a motorcycle, gonna jump over some trucks, oh hum, you know, and they gave him a bigger cut of the gate, whatever it is, because they didn't think they'd have over 10, 15 people in the stands, and they were used to promoting a lot of country western shows at the deal. They never had anything like this. And when they packed that both days, I mean, sell out crowds and doing that, it finally got their attention. Like, holy crap, you know, we gave away a lot of money, you know, when they just judged the book by its cover and they didn't know how, you know, much people were really enthused about going and seeing this.
Yeah, I mean think about that too. Like selling the show of a jump. I mean, let's face it, the actual jump itself, how long does it take, Henry? I mean, how long are you airborne? 5 to 7 seconds. Right. I mean, to sell that is an impressive job in itself.
Well, the actual jump is almost, if you do it correctly, the actual jump is almost, anticlimactic.
Yes. There was a lot of film taken in it. Because,
exactly.
They make a run for the mill. They start taking pictures and everything, and he never jumped. And then all of a sudden, he did it, and they didn't have their camera ready. The flash wouldn't go off or whatever it was.
Right.
Well, it's all over with. It's done.
Oh, boy. Life of being a daredevil.
It's better than it sounds, I promise.
So anything else you guys want to add to the whole chasing evil party?
Well, I'm just totally stoked that, Robbie claims he's going to keep jumping. As long as he doesn't hurt himself, permanently, I'm all for it. I love that dude. I'm excited to see this film. And, all three of us are fans of the family. And, Mike knows a lot more than we do. But, I guess there's another one coming after this. So there'll be a trilogy. So, I'm excited to see it.
Well, I think, that it sounds like Robbie's changing stuff around, and I think Bill hit a lot of stuff on the head that he had a lot of that stuff, the DUI. And I think that if you've seen that picture of him sitting at the table there in the courtroom, I couldn't believe that was Robbie. I mean, it just looked totally different. And to hear him on the radio tonight, he sounds more upbeat, and he sounded like what he wants to do, and I wish he could get to the point, and I think he's starting to get to the point that they're going to see him as Robbie Knievel in what he did, so he can sign autographs, sign T-shirts, and pay for all of his dues. I mean, he's paid his dues. He just needs somebody to that's kind of what Evel got to doing, in his later years and stuff, even though his health really went bad. He had something he could tour with, and people remembered. They'd come up, they'd have autographs, they still had their kids, their dads, and all that stuff. And about doing this, and that's, and Evel didn't have to come there, and all he had to do is be in the parade and shake hands and do stuff. And that's, I think that's going to be great. And, Robbie's even, they've got Robbie's stuff in the museum up there. They've got his leathers, and they've got some of the stuff on him performing with his dad and doing stuff. They didn't leave him out on any of that stuff. So I'm hoping that, if he wants to come by the museum and do it when they have their opening and stuff, I think that'll be great. And I think there'll be a lot of people that really shake his hand and, shaking a hand of a Knievel. So.
Absolutely.
I hope one day Robbie gets his own museum.
Could possibly do it. It's just, or add another section to this one. I think it'll be.
Absolutely.
Both of them.
And then just a few feet down the hall, there'll be the Pitbull section.
Well, I was up there and everything, we're taking a tour of that, and I said, and I looked at the closet door, and I said, is this a display for me and Lee? And they kind of laughed. They said, yeah, we could probably squeeze that in there. So
Oh, that's funny. Cool. You know what? I, as you said that, I never seen the pictures from the courtroom. I'm just looking at them now. Yeah, you wouldn't even know that was Robbie.
Did you see the X-rays?
The X-rays?
Yeah, did you see these X-rays, Barry?
Oh.
Yeah, Mike sent them to me. They're gnarly looking.
Looked like a big killer zipper on his back.
Oh, boy.
And then he was, Robbie was talking about, I heard him talking earlier about that cage around his spine. And then you look in there and there's a broken bolt in the middle of it.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what he was talking about when he landed. I can't remember which jump it was that Bill was talking about that he landed in. And that's the one that they broke. And then they had to go back in there and remove all that stuff and redo it. And you only get too many times. It's like a wood screw that pulls out the hole and everything. You can only patch that so many times, and
right
when you don't have enough material to keep doing that. So that's like, I'm hoping that he doesn't have to jump no 100 feet or a deal. He can jump over 3, 4, 5 cars, and I think still impress a lot of people about doing that. And if he just has to do that, I hope he just doesn't think he's got to drive, you know, he's 400 or 500 feet to go.
Well, I can tell you from experience.
And I'm not really stacking it on, he said the jumper, the Daredevil, the bird, you know, it's how high he goes while doing that. Not putting him down, but there's a lot of people that know who he is.
That's exactly right.
And, you know, here this guy, that guy is really risking big, big things to try to make, a name for himself. And, you know, talk about Evel jumping 140 feet like that. And, you know, the guy's known worldwide. So really jumping further and further and further, you know, and getting paid the same amount of money and doing that with more injury. You know, that just kind of, that's what Evel was talking about. He says, I don't have to jump a long ways to keep my name.
That's absolutely
and
right.
And I'm hoping Robbie does that. You know, he just takes a mile jumps, and I mean, any of them are scary that you could do, anything could happen, but I just hope that that's what he does.
I can tell you personally, there's something inside of me, and I'm sure Rob and every other jumper out there, we just want to go out and do it. I'd be out there doing it in the field by myself, and maybe one day people will hear that former Daredevil, blah, 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 died because he fell over with a heart attack at 92 years old out jumping ramps with his four-wheeler.
Yep.
But I want to do it.
I
crave to do it, and I'm sure Robbie's not any different. And it's not so much about the, you know, you set a challenge for yourself, and you go out there and you want to accomplish it. And, you know, if you can make money and you get people to come see you and maybe influence people, you know, positively, then
exactly,
we're better for it.
Yep. And you got to... And people remember how showmanship you do. I mean, there's lots of jumpers. I mean, I got looked at all the different motorcycle jumpers and stuff, and I recognize a few of them, but not all of them. And, you know, and you go ask anybody that they, you know, about a motorcycle jumper. Now, they'll either come up now and they'll say, Robbie Knievel. You know, it used to be, you know, everything you ask somebody would be Evel, you know, a Knievel, a motorcycle jumper. They spell his first name wrong. They don't know that, but they do remember a guy being a motorcycle jumper as him. And, but see, Evel, you know, like I said, he was a good promoter. He got on some shows. He got Joey Bishop, you know, to put him on his deal. Carson got his deal. You were talking about Donnie and Marie. That was a hot show back in the 70s. You know, that couldn't have. He got lots of publicity off that one, too. He was getting a different crowd and stuff. It's and then that movie, you know, Bionic Woman was a hot thing going on there, and here he was in a movie.
George Hamilton's playing him in a movie.
Yep.
He's playing himself in a movie. I mean,
yep.
People don't realize how huge he was. And I would have liked nothing better than to see Robbie parlay that like his dad did, but it just didn't happen.
No, there was just a lot of two different kind of personalities, and they just they're both good at what they do, but I just think Evel had a little bit more BS to him, a little bit more snake oil and stuff to promote himself, and he got in that door. And I think Robbie's looking for that door, and if he's doing it, he's knocking on this one, because it sounds like he's changed his altitude. You know, find out that that's one thing that his dad didn't really. You never saw him getting down really, really drunk. He just never did do that. And being intoxicated and doing, you know, he did a couple of interviews, you know, where he had a few and stuff, but he never got it where he was just really drunk. And
right.
That's one thing that Evel always promoted about doing this, because he wanted to be known. I mean, I had to, when Evel got in trouble and stuff, he remembered back when he was at Bob Hope Golf Classic, and he happened to cuss in front of his wife, Dolores Hope. And he got to thinking about that, and he wrote a real, you know, letter apologizing for that. You know, I don't, you know, usually talk like that in the public. I'm sorry. I told her, you know, bad. She might not even heard it, but he thought that she did. And we had to buy 12 white roses and take this letter to Bob Hope's house, which Carl Green and I did that. We went over to Bob Hope's house. He wasn't there. They were in Palm Springs. So if you've ever been around Evel, when he tells you, I want you to personally deliver this, I want you to go get this, we drove to Palm Springs that night and delivered it to the house. Took these, had to find these white roses, which were out of season. I finally found a florist in Los Angeles, and we took them to Palm Springs to the house. And the maid that was there, she said that she's already in bed, but she says, I'll make sure that she gets this personally in the morning. And I said, okay. Now, it kind of got us by. You know, we pull up there, and there's two crazy guys got flowers and deals to Dolores Hope. We were in the red Cadillac pickup, so it looked good. So we were, but it worked out pretty good. But it's like that, that Evel just didn't want to be known to that. Now, he could get his temper up and going stuff, but he never really got falling down drunk. He never got, you know, some of that stuff. We just seen him drink a lot, but he, you know, when he would be out there and partying, and he gets to doing those shots and stuff. But usually when he got the feeling, he'd go back to his room. He didn't stay up and do that. So that's one thing that, you know, Robbie's got bad for him. He's got the DUI. He's got some other stuff on him. And he had a lot to overcome, but it sounds like he's doing a lot better.
That's good. That is definitely good.
And I hope he does.
Me too. And hopefully that, you know.
And this film, this new film to come out that they got, I think is going to help. I think it helped him a lot to see that and going, wow, there is somebody that cares. There is somebody that's looking. And yeah, that is my story. That's what I'm doing. So sometimes it takes something like that to have somebody look at it and go, wow, I did all that, you know. And
I think he would be surprised to see how long of a memory all of his fans really have, because, you know, as a jumper and a fan of theirs, I just absolutely love watching that stuff, and I haven't forgotten a thing.
Nope. They know exactly what. I mean, he's got some pretty good fan base. the ones when we were there at the Las Vegas at that time, you know, when he jumped over those 30 limos, he had a terrific, you know, and then, you know, he had another guy come along, Spanky Spangler, you know, that was a daredevil doing some stuff in cars, you know, flipping the car over in the boxes and stuff. And Spanky made his name quite a little bit. In fact, at the same time, or not at the same time, Robbie did his deal down at the other hotel, and then Spanky Spangler did his jump at the New Orleans hotel up there and jumped over that, and his jump kind of went a little haywire, and he missed the boxes and flipped over on top, and Robbie was there, went over there and helped him get out of his seatbelt and stuff. But, you know, it's a small world. After you get into that deal, you meet a lot of different people.
Yes, you do.
So, I'm sure. Cool. Well, let's wrap this show on up. It's been an honor, Mike. It's always an honor to talk to you and hear the stories and the insight from you.
Knievel family going through a lot, you know, and these two guys have done some stuff. And like I said, I'm glad that Robbie sound like he's coming out of his shell and he's going to do some stuff. And kind of surprised me about the two dummies and stuff that he's you know, he's going to do his dads and stuff and comedy act. I thought that was like, this is a little far on the other side. And I don't know, Henry, is that something you're going to do later on? Or
that's nothing. I do the comedy act right now every time I talk about Super Joe Reed.
Okay. So I'm, like I said, I'm hoping he does well. He's gone through an awful lot, so I think he can probably, if he get all this stuff going and move ahead, I think he'll be okay.
Yeah.
I want to see it happen.
Absolutely.
Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure.
Absolutely. Always a pleasure, guys. Thanks, everybody, okay, who tuned in tonight. Thanks to Lathan, Jesse James, and, of course, Robbie for calling in. And
yes.
We're all proud of you, Robbie, and we're all looking forward to the film and looking for the big comeback and turnaround of your life and career. So,
love you, Mike. Love you, Bay. You guys have a good holiday.
Okay. See you guys later.
Take care, guys. All right, everybody, thanks again for tuning in. And remember, not only to stay driven, but happy landings. Take care, everybody.